Beyond our reports, we've got a citation to read, and we have a pinning tonight, which is always a joyous occasion, and for the new police officer, and a full agenda of visitors. The Garden Club will be here, the Council on Aging, and we have an MAPC member report. RCTV will be in, and the town manager is going to review his goals with us, along with a financial update for conversation among ourselves and the public, as well as some hearings a little bit later, both alcohol-related, and some minutes to approve. So I think we should get started with liaison reports. Mr. N.
Other than town meeting, haven't been too busy. No report.
Okay. Barry?
Business travel and town meeting took it out of me, so nothing to report.
Okay. And John?
Just wanted to thank my colleagues for manning the pumps while I was on business travel for town meeting. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it has been very busy. Lots of second shift work going on, but most of it not liaison work. So I think we'll kind of move on. We do have this evening a proclamation, which I will ask our secretary to read.
This proclamation is in honor of Women's Lung Health Week. Whereas every 8 minutes, one woman in the U.S. loses her battle with lung cancer, and whereas lung cancer is the number one cancer killer of women and men in the U.S., and whereas the number of women dying from lung cancer has nearly doubled over the past 30 years, and whereas advocacy and increased awareness will result in more and better treatments and early detection for people with lung cancer that will ultimately save lives, and whereas Lung Force is a fast-growing initiative led by the American Lung Association with the mission of making lung cancer history, uniting the nation in the fight against lung cancer. Now, therefore, we, the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading, Massachusetts, do hereby proclaim May 9th through the 15th, 2016, as Women's Lung Health Week in the Town of Reading, and encourage all residents to learn more about the detection and treatment of lung cancer. Is there someone to?
I'll move that proclamation be entered into the record.
Second.
All those in favor?
Okay. Mr. Chairman, should we go back to public comment and town manager?
Yes, I missed that one, and I should not have done that.
That's okay.
Mr. Chairman, is there someone that gets?
Not this evening, but we're going to pass that along to the appropriate person.
Okay. We need another
signal
order.
Record. Here, leave it for Kevin. And at this time, we have any public comment. Any members of the public like to comment on anything that wasn't necessarily on the agenda or that they'd like to talk about this evening? Okay, now we're a little ahead of schedule here as far as the police officer badge pinning. I think we should probably move down to, we could go to approval of minutes, I guess. Could
sure.
We, could we not? Yes.
If you would, I have one issue that I even didn't make your agenda. I overlooked it in many ways. I was under the impression that the Charter Committee had revised the reappointment process for the town accountant to June. But it's actually March, so you forgot to appoint her, so I told her to take the last 2 months off. So there's a motion in your packet to approve, to appoint Sharon as town accountant through March 31st, 2017, and we'll try to remember to do that next March.
Okay.
Is it in?
Oh, yeah, it's there.
We did, the Charter Committee did remove the annual appointment of town council, feeling that that was an at-will appointment. And likewise, the treasurer-collector, I used to have to appoint every year, and that was removed by the charter. But the charter folks felt that this was still important, that this is an independent voice that you appoint, and you should say that every year, somewhat like the town moderator for town.
Town council also, yeah.
Town council, you just appoint at will. So you
at
can
will.
Hire them and fire them any day you want.
Without an appointment.
Great. Well, it sounds like we should entertain a motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen reappoint Sharon Angstrom as town council.
Town accountant.
Sorry.
She's got a promotion.
Yeah.
I'm not
well,
sure.
You're a second job like everybody else.
Move to the Board of Selectmen reappoint Sharon Angstrom as town accountant for a term expiring March 31st, 2017.
Second.
Discussion.
She's doing a great job.
Yeah.
She is doing a great job.
I mean, if we only get to thank her once a year, let this be the night. I think she's doing a great job.
She's not even here to accept, so.
Well, it's on TV. Our friends at RCTV are
I'm sure
streaming live.
Accepting on behalf of Sharon.
Yes, exactly.
Sure.
All those in favor?
She's upstairs.
She's working.
4-0.
Thank you.
And you know, Bob, I also, I'm kind of new at this chair job, so I did skip you in regard to some other comments that you might have.
No, I don't have any other comments, John, but I think it'd be worth just letting the board members and the public know that the liaison assignments have been finalized.
Yes.
So that, we'll post those on the website. I've sent them to department heads and also to members.
Yeah, those were circulated among you guys over the course of the last 2 weeks, I think, and nobody ran for the hills, so we're going to stand as written. So, and that is important for, I know that there has been some, you know, a couple of questions as to who was assigned where, and there's been a lot of reassignments that have gone on, so we take care of that.
Mr. Chairman, may I revisit Selectmen's liaison reports? I did not want this occasion to pass without really commending both town and school staff and elected officials for a great presentation. I thought the schools was very in-depth this year. It provided multiple year budget information and expending information. I think this is all excellent. Although there's not a lot of debate at town meeting, it's good to have this on the record for future use as we move into the consideration of a 2.5 override. So I think it was a job well done. It's the best set of reporting I've seen in quite a while. Hope it was helpful.
Any other comments from the board? You know, one of the things that will probably come up when we get down into our discussion of the financial update, and it's not exactly a liaison report, but as I think all of you know, and I've said this in these meetings before, as we move downstream towards the fall and the ballot question that will be in front of our citizens, part of the homework that I've been doing in the background, and you know, have encouraged all of you to do the same, is that I've been visiting along with Bob with our assessor, looking at the various tools that are available under the tax levy, how they can be adopted, how they can be adjusted, what we can do individually, what we can do, you know, collectively. And I will just say that there's an awful lot, there's a lot to learn. We probably think that, I mean, at least I came into this job a number of years ago thinking that your taxes are your taxes and there's enough to go around, or there isn't. If there's not enough to go around, then you have to go get some more. And it seemed fairly straightforward, although when you start to examine the various tools that make up the levy, it's very in-depth and required. I'm glad we've got plenty of time to work on that over time, and I'm sure at some point we'll invite our assessor back in to have a visit with all of us together. So although that's not really a liaison report, it's kind of an update on some of the things that are being worked on as we go along. We are still a little bit ahead of schedule here, and I think probably one of the pieces of business we can take care of is the approval of the minutes of the April 19th meeting. I know you've all received those.
Mm-hmm.
Wonder if there's any corrections or additions.
Should I just make the motion?
Yeah.
Yeah. Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of April 19, 2016 as amended.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0? 4-0-1. Sorry about that. Mr. Arena was away on business. And now, Mr. Sexton is here. Liaison report?
I do not have any liaison report as of yet.
Town meeting kind of takes the steam out of
it. It does take a little steam out of the liaison
reports. It really does.
We should also do the executive session,
yeah,
too.
Yes.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the executive session minutes of April 19, 2016 as written. And I guess this is a roll call.
It is.
Do I have a second?
Second.
I second.
All those in favor of the minutes, and let me take these.
You have to do it as a roll call.
Okay. You want to do the roll call?
I'll do it.
Okay.
Mr. Halsey?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Arena, you were?
Abstaining.
Mr. Ensminger?
Yes.
Barry Berman?
Yes.
401 on the executive session minutes.
Yep.
Of the same date. So, I'm wondering if we
financial
could
update or town manager roles would be a suggestion.
I don't know that we've got time for either one of those. The financial update was scheduled for a longer period.
Yeah, and I think there'll be people coming.
And I do think we need to leave that. And I think, given where that is and given the circumstances, I suspect we may have some people coming to visit us a little bit later.
We could see if they're are here.
Yeah, I can go out and ask.
Yeah, we can check with that, and you know, possibly.
Yeah.
Right.
I know some of the members of the Garden Club are here. I don't know if they're ready to roll. So we could go there too. It's so rare when I chair a meeting that we're ahead of schedule.
Oh, we have time to.
Yeah, I was going to say. Don't slide into
nobody
the
blink.
Hole.
Let that go.
Things all set.
Okay, good.
They all set?
Yep.
Okay,
excellent.
Great.
Come on down.
Oh, open the other door.
No bagpipes.
That was really bizarre, that one. It was fabulous.
That was great with the bagpipes.
I love this part of the job.
Yep. Good evening.
Good evening.
Hello.
Come on in.
Hello. Come on in.
Suspenseful.
Here we go.
Don't fit.
March.
Oh.
Yeah. Please. Good evening. Thank you for having us.
Good evening, Chief.
Good evening. One of our newest officers, Officer Brian Lewis, is here tonight in front of you. He has his badge painted by his wife. Brian grew up in North Reading. He worked in the big state of New Hampshire for the last 6.5 years for the Portsmouth, New Hampshire Police Department. And we're glad he came back. Brian graduated 2003 from North Reading High, graduated 2007 from UMass Lowell, and graduated in 2008 from the Mass State Police Academy prior to going up to New Hampshire. Okay, introduce your wife tonight.
Tonight, pinning me is my wife, Colleen, and also with me is my father, Bill, my mother, Maggie, and my friends, Casey, Chris, Greg, Polly, Dan, and my father-in-law, Bill, from hiding in the back.
Present.
Home.
Congratulations. Welcome.
Welcome.
Congratulations, Brian.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Welcome back, Brian.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. This has been a long-standing tradition that we've wanted for a long time now. Coming in front of you all, we really appreciate it.
I think it's fantastic.
It's always a great night when you guys are all here.
Makes our day every time.
Thank you.
Sure. Oh, sure.
Whatever you want to do.
All rise.
sure we're in there.
Congratulations, Brian.
Chief Cormier had a tradition to go around and
nicknick that. I was going to ask.
Yeah. Well, I decided to stop that. But again, we have the honor guide and all the other officers of the Reading Police Department here tonight to welcome Brian. So again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Safer. Yeah.
It's good.
Just for a few minutes. Yeah.
Surrounded by guns that aren't pointed at me. It's an awesome feeling.
That are fully automatic.
That's great.
The annexation of North Reading takes one step.
Well, just, you know, get their sons and get them on the
That's right.
On
We're
the
bringing
force.
Them over one at a time.
Going to be a
trying to take them one at a time.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks again. Thank you. Congratulations to all of you.
Yeah.
I couldn't move that.
Now they get to go out and celebrate. We get to sit here. Right. Well, in keeping with this rare occasion to be ahead of schedule, I think the Garden Club is ready to roll. Is that right? Are we ready to hear from the Garden Club? Good. Let's
All right.
go.
Yeah.
Great.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Dimitri.
So there are five of us here tonight.
Wow. Please introduce
so
everybody that's here.
Okay. Denise McCarthy, who's going to be the president going forward, so you'll be hearing from her in the future.
All right.
Jean Maloney Stewart, who has been one of our Ways and Means committee members for how many years? Many. Marlene Cohen, who's also been a member of the Ways and Means Committee for many years. And Mary Ann Higgins, who is the chair of the Ways and Means Committee, and she's sort of in charge of the plant sale, which we're mostly here to talk about. So between us, there's, what, 30, 40 years of garden clubbing.
Look at all the money people here tonight.
Yeah, the money people are definitely here tonight. So I'm going to do a quick update, and then I'll ask Mary Ann to jump in on the plant sale a bit. It's spring, believe it or not, it's spring. So we're busy again. We've come outdoors. We're back into the community. If you're over at the Parker Tavern, you'll see that the gardens there are gorgeous. The Depot Garden, the tree I just pulled over and I checked, it's about to bud. It's looking beautiful. The gardens here at the Town Hall that we've renovated and built are looking great. They came through the winter. We've also, in partnership with the town, have planted 12 Yoshino cherries down at the depot in big, beautiful faux terracotta pots. And we are looking for people to adopt them. They are adopt an island sites. They used to be the whiskey barrels, and those were rotting and falling apart. So that's exciting. It's something for our gardeners in town who want to get involved. We're looking for adopt an islanders. We Adopt an Island is up and running. Our outreach community group has been very busy. We're doing Reading Scholarship. We continue to support the Reading food pantry, the Mission of Deeds. We just partnered with the library for a climate change talk, which was really great. A guy came and spoke about climate change, and the climate committee was very helpful in getting people out. We had a full house. So, but the real thing that we're here to talk about is our Geraniums and More sale, which is on May 14th, and it's right out there. And I'd like you to take over, if you don't mind, to talk a little bit about it. Because everyone in Reading, this is a great community event, and we want a lot of people there.
So, I think, well, there's two main things that I'd like to let people know about geraniums and Morsia. The very first, very important thing is all proceeds go right back to the town. As part of our, I guess you'd call it our charter of, for the garden club, we can't keep any of the money. We need to give it back to the town. So that is why we really hope everyone is going to be supporting our efforts on Saturday, May 14th. And the second thing I'd like to let everyone know is the garden club is so appreciative of Bob and his group, of all the support they have given to us last year and this year, since we normally would have held this at the library. We because of the renovation, we couldn't do that anymore, and we were looking for a site, and so this is where we landed, on the town common. And with all the changes and all the logistics, I do want to recognize Bob and his crew, all the other people in town, the DPW and police and everybody, for all the help that they have given us with our efforts. So, another thing to note about our geraniums and more plant sale is that there's really four or five sections. One section is the bake sale. We sell all homemade goods from the our members. The second thing is we have a very, very popular section called Members Plants. These are tried and true plants that are growing in our gardens. We dig them up and share them with the community. And these are things, plants that you can't really, a lot of them you can't buy anymore because they're older strains of certain plants and so on. So, and some you can. So we sell a lot of daylilies and so on, which you can also buy. But so that's the members' plans, the bake sale. We have lots of geraniums. We have some beautiful colors this year that are new, so I hope everyone enjoys those. And then we have the annuals. The annuals are plants that don't come back every year. You have to keep planting them. So we have lots and lots of those. And then we also have the we have vegetables and herbs and hanging baskets. So those are the varieties that you could you can see on Saturday the 14th. So let's see what else. Oh, and we have to mention that the, it's not called the
Arts Reading.
Yeah, Arts Reading.
Arts Reading is going to join us on the Common, and they're going to share information about each of their groups. And I'm not sure, I think the Reading
it's gonna be arts, five groups.
Five groups,
yeah.
The arts, Creative Arts, Art Association, the yep. Library.
Colonial Course Players, Arts Reading, and Historical Commission.
Yeah. And yep. some will be performing and depending on the weather and so on, but, right?
We're not planning any performances.
No performances,
no.
Okay. No one's gonna dress up.
Dramatic reading.
We'll see. Okay, so that's another important part of piece to our Saturday fun. So, are there any questions, or can you think of anything else we should add?
What's the time?
9 to 11.
Everyone listening at home, 9 to 1 p.m. on the 14th of May.
Four
hours.
9 a.m. to 1. And if
excellent.
You want a fresh baked rhubarb pie, get there early because go fast.
And a lot of the members' plants went early last year, too. Yeah. I tend to got there on the later side and lost out on that plant that was supposed to attract the butterflies. I forget what it was.
Oh,
yeah.
Milkweed
plant.
We have 20.
We're selling them again,
yep.
Different
yes.
kind.
Okay.
So you can save the monarchs and beautify your garden all the same
and
time.
And I was very disappointed that I did not have it, get any
I'll
from my garden.
Aside.
Thank you.
Friday night, camp
yeah.
out.
Yeah, right.
The butterfly week this year.
Occupy Reading.
Okay, any other comments
yes.
or any questions?
Yeah, just one observation. The street in front of Town Hall will be closed to the traffic. Parking is most easily available behind the CVS in that municipal lot, and is also available behind Town Hall, and there will be a police detail, especially for the CVS lot, to help people cross safely that have bought plants and often have wagons and so forth.
And
you're having the scouts?
We will have the Boy Scouts from the Methodist Church helping to carry the plants to people's cars.
Oh, nice.
Because
okay.
We know it's
great.
It's quite a way.
Yes, great.
Great. They've been terrific.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, Kevin.
Just a real quick question. I know you had a change of venue. Last year was the first year at the Common, correct? Is there any correlation? Do we see any numbers change as far as sales go?
Up.
It went up?
They went up.
Okay.
Yeah. Much higher visibility.
Yeah, that's what I'd assume. You might get a little bit better jump on that at that location.
And the partnership with Arts Reading was great, and we're glad we're doing it again, and I hope it continues to be a thing. We
excellent.
All enjoyed that mm-hmm. a lot.
Yeah, I was there last year. It was actually, it was an event more than it
right.
was a sale. It was pretty fun. There was a lot of folks attending, so.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to it again this year.
And it's rain or shine. Among
all the flowers, yep. It's just so pretty. Mary Ann?
Yes.
Just that, I take that train every single day, and I noticed the cherry blossoms when they came up. That was something new, and they looked terrific, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Very much.
Master gardener.
We have a master gardener.
Yes.
Well, I'm not a master gardener.
Yeah. We will have on-site, we will have master gardeners who are able to answer most questions that you have about plants. These are people who have, in our club, who have studied botany and so on.
In what form of payments do you have for folks to use?
Check or cash?
Check or cash, okay.
Cash is king.
Cash is always king.
Good question. Okay, so
thank you.
Yeah.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you
very
you know
much.
What? I just like to really say thank you to your organization. You guys you do a beautiful job of making the town more beautiful, and it's a tireless effort. And you know, I don't think it's a thankless effort. However, I think people really do appreciate it, and they recognize what you've been doing. And you know, it's Adopt the Island pretty soon, right? We're going to be judging those soon.
I don't know if there's going to be a contest this year, but Adopt an Island
site
will be available.
We're revamping the
should.
Adopt an Island.
Oh, okay. Well,
a little bit, just trying to mainstream.
Well, they're everywhere, and that's
yeah.
good
yeah.
Because we see them everywhere, and you do fabulous work. Now, you guys have been doing this a long time.
60 years.
60
60th
years.
60th anniversary this year.
I pointed to Denise because Denise is honoring the 60th anniversary of this organization with our end of year party. She's
our
putting it together.
Banquet. 60
wow.
shades of green.
Okay. Lance away, ladies.
We're
going to
move
away.
On to the Council on Aging. Real quickly before you do go, the Adopt an Island, if somebody wanted to, is it through the town website? And how do they get in touch to actually
adopt
an island?
Adopt an Island?
Yes.
You can get in touch through our website or.
Which is?
What is our website?
ReddingGardenClub.org. ReddingGardenClub.org. Okay.
And we often get emails from people in Pennsylvania
yeah.
who want
yeah.
things from us, but
well.
We send them.
Don't ship.
Too late to change.
Pennsylvania, a little too far.
Right.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
I know how that works because the high school in Redding, Pennsylvania has the Redding Bulldogs.
Oh, really?
That's an interesting coincidence. So I do hear from them too. Pennsylvania
right.
guys want to know what the schedule is. It's very interesting.
Long distance relationship.
Thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you
very
much.
Thank you. And I think it's time for us to have an update from the Council on Aging.
I warmed it up for you.
Thank you.
Just.
This is right here.
Okay.
No, it was that day we.
Oh, yeah.
It was brutal. It was fun, though.
Oh.
Okay. So, thank you all very much for inviting us here this evening. It's something that we're excited about presenting. We have several members of the Council on Aging here this evening. We have John Parsons, Jolyn Eck, Sandy Schaefer, Marilyn Shapley, Brian Snell. Did I get everyone? I know we have a few folks out sick and injured right now. So it's a great group. We are a council of 10 members that work in it as an advisory capacity towards for Reading Elder and Human Services. So to start off this evening, I'm hoping you recall back in September, we had a townwide survey. We asked the community to evaluate Reading Elder Services from the current programs and services that we are offering, and also to tell us what types of programs and services the community wanted us to either continue or bring into the community. I have preliminary results, and I don't want to use the time tonight to go into depth with the survey. I just wanted to give you a brief overview. What we learned from the survey, we had 378 people take the survey. What we learned that what people valued the most in the community that took the survey was the socialization at the Pleasant Street Center. That 3/4 of the people that took the survey felt that that was a real value to the community. Followed by how we communicate with programs and services, and then transportation, both the medical transportation that I'll go into a little bit later on, as well as the elder services van. And that was followed by our wellness, education, and fitness programs, which was really nice to hear considering we've brought on a full-time nurse advocate, to know that the town really values the wellness programs that we offer. What they told us going forward, and the greatest challenge that Reading seniors are currently facing, is health issues. We didn't ask folks to elaborate, but we asked them out of a list of items, what do you think are the greatest challenges? Health and aging healthy within the community came up as one of the largest concerns, followed by financial issues, and then again, companionship and socialization. So I expect within the next month we'll have the final results that we will include in one of your packets, and we can talk more about the results going forward. But tonight, we wanted to focus on what does it mean to age in Reading. And when you think of Elder and Human Services, we really are a division with two arms. We have the Pleasant Street Center, which is our adult community center, supported by the Council on Aging, who they support us both financially through the trust funds and also through an advisory capacity. But we also have social services and nurse advocacy. It's nice now that we've moved social services into the Pleasant Street Center, so we're all contained within one building. And that's really helped on both ends. Folks coming in for fitness or socialization are more comfortable about seeking out services because they're familiar with the staff. And residents who come in looking for help get introduced to the center. So we've seen an increase in attendance overall by balancing having social services and the center at the center as well as programming. So social services. I didn't want to bore you with a bunch of bullet points, and I thought a story would be a better way to give you a sense of what we do in social services and nurse advocacy. When you look at this, it's a bunch of words on a piece of paper that don't really make any sense. And in a nutshell, that's what our senior case manager and our nurse advocate do. They make sense of all of this. They make sense of Mass Health, of Medicare, of SHINE, of AARP tax assistance, Lifeline. They work with seniors to help them navigate through the aging process and through a lot of the government and state programs. On an average day-to-day basis, they will go visit a senior to help fill out medical transportation and come to find out Mr. and Mrs. Smith don't have any heating oil. And they're heating their home through a 40-year-old electric heater and maybe a stove. We've had situations where through relationship building in the community, we've worked with elders that have no working plumbing. And they don't have the cognitive ability to resolve that issue. And in situations when it's arisen, we work with the DPW first to determine, is it a town issue or a homeowner issue? and then we work with the resident to resolve the issue, which is typically beyond the normal call a plumber situation. On a larger scale, I wanted to tell you about Sam. Names have been changed to protect the resident. Sam is an 80-year-old elder that came in to the center not too long ago. He was having trouble with the bill. He didn't understand the bill. He didn't understand what it was for or how to make payment. So our case manager worked with him to help him sort through it. A few days later, she followed up to offer Sam a home-delivered holiday meal, which the Council on Aging provides to seniors. He didn't recall coming into the center, and he didn't recall the conversation. He didn't want the meal. A few days later, our nurse advocate called the senior to say, I really think this would be great for you. She had noticed when he came in, his clothes weren't fitting properly, indicating a weight loss. Through the relationship building, she was able to get him to accept the meal. A few days later, she delivered the meal at his home, which gave her an opportunity for a home visit. Through talking with the elder, she learned that he had recently fallen in his home and had hit his head. He had a doctor's appointment. He didn't know the name of the doctor or where the doctor was located. She went back to the office, through some very good detective work, was able to find the doctor's office, find the appointment, and gain permission from the elder to talk with the doctor's office regarding his condition. She established a relationship with the nurse practitioner in the office. In the meantime, she contacted the Reading Police, trying to find a next of kin contact. Fortunately, the Reading Police had that next of kin contact because his son had recently done a wellness check on him. She contacted the son, who lived out in Arizona, and informed the son of her concerns and of the doctor's office concerns. She also made a referral to Mystic Valley Elder Services. So now this elder, who simply walked in the center confused about a bill, his children are involved with the care, his doctor's office has an established relationship with our department, and Mystic Valley is working with the elder to get the services in place, along with both Kerry and Elise. There's no typical day, but if I had to give you a summary of the types of things that we face in the social services side of elder services, that would be fairly typical. It involves many hours of detective work, conversations, and relationship building in order to assist many of the elders in town. Yes.
Jane, I have to say, that was a very compelling story. Until you went through it, I'd always thought of elder services as predominantly delivery of services. And what you're describing is there's a whole lot of discovery that's got to go on long before you can ever get to the point of delivering anything. And it certainly was lost on me. I mean, I know of individual cases of people have difficulty with memory and mm-hmm. doing daily affairs, but you're describing this as kind of part and parcel of what you're doing on a regular basis.
It is, and that's why many people don't understand what we do, and many people in the community don't understand what we do. And that's why when I was talking with the council about the presentation tonight, instead of putting up a bunch of bullet items saying home care, which it's hard to understand, yeah. I thought a story of what we do is more compelling.
Boy, it sure is.
And, you know, there's a million stories in the Naked City. I could go on all night.
We heard about 60 Shades of Green. So, okay. So you can pretty much have anything you want.
I don't want to go down there. But it is. What we do is relationship building. And wow. Sometimes it's a quick 15-minute phone call and someone is all set, they're good, and they move on. But sometimes it can be hours and hours of work. And a lot of it is being a detective. It's tracking down family members. It's tracking down doctor's offices. You know, I would be remiss without throwing some numbers at you. And I can tell you our numbers are ticking up. We're projected to, you know, this is where we are in red for the current time. As we are trending, we will be up around 2,700 service units.
What do you call a service unit?
A service unit is a contact with a resident, but what this doesn't tell you is that contact could be a 15-minute phone call or 2 hours. It's still counted as one unit.
And one person could have multiple
contacts. One person usually does have multiple. Right. The story with Sam, that happened over the course of a 3-week period. Stories like that, they do happen over a long period of time. It's building a relationship. When I've looked at a dip in service that we've had, it's because we have a new staff member that takes hours, really a year, to get on board and train. I can tell you our nurse advocate started in November. Within the first week, she made an impact on the division already. And I think that's why our numbers are higher. You know, when you look at FY16, you have to remember Elise just started in November and has already made an impact on the services that we are able to deliver to the community.
Jane, in the story you told about Sam mm-hmm. I think his name was, mm-hmm. So that whole thing sort of was precipitated when Sam had the initiative to walk into
right.
the center. Is there any way to know about the Sams that are out there that A, don't have the knowledge or the capability of are there basically hidden seniors that we know are out there?
Absolutely.
And so what efforts, you know, do you undertake to try to, you know, find them before, you know, something bad happens?
Thank you for that lead-in. we don't work in a vacuum. We work with everyone. I will tell you, a week does not go by that we don't hear from police or fire or both. Sometimes it's multiple cases. Sometimes it's a quick email. Sometimes it's a phone call. But we have a very strong working relationship with both police and fire. Really, our paramedics are one of our best sources of outreach to the community. They break down the barriers if they respond to an elder, and
sure.
they will say to the elder, you know, how about if we have someone from Elder Services give you a call? Police and fire are really one of our best resources. We've gotten referrals from the library. Because a senior will frequent the library and then all of a sudden not be there. And the library is really good about giving us a call and saying, I haven't seen this senior in a while. You know, can you look into it? And we will look into it. Mystic Valley, we talk a lot about Mystic Valley Elder Services. That's a two-way relationship. We refer people to Mystic Valley Elder Services, but they refer people back to us. People that either are resistant to their help or are ineligible for their help, or in some circumstances, we have better services. Our medical transportation is a model for many communities that they're looking at what we offer. So all of these, and these are just the ones I could find cute logos for. we work with all of these. We work with Health, Greater Lawrence Action Council for yep. fuel assistance. Mission of Deeds, St. Vincent de Paul, we do a lot of client sharing. We see homelessness in Reading.
Yep.
Family homelessness, I will tell you, last August, during a 2-week period, we dealt with 3 homeless situations. And that was in 1 month. It doesn't happen every month, thank goodness. But we know that they're there, and we will work with Mission of Deeds and St. Vincent de Paul. We work with Rotary, Lions, Reading Care, Hallmark, Sanborn, and many, many others. We work with neighbors who will call us and over concern about a neighbor. Businesses will call us. So we have many, many partnerships. We are growing partnerships. This year, we've had a growth in a relationship with our CASA. The drug problem isn't just in our youth. We see addiction problems in our seniors. And as, not to pick on the boomers, but as the boomers become seniors, we'll see more and more addiction. So we actually work with our CASA because Julianne is also a social worker, and she has the knowledge on addiction. So when we come across a resident who is either a senior or close to a senior with an addiction problem will involve our CASA in that as well.
I know that's an initiative of the Board of Health this year, mm-hmm. too. I know that's one of the things in their, mm-hmm. you know, in their plan, yep. was to target really, mm-hmm. you know, that group kind of 25 to 65.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're working at one end and, you know, the schools are working at the other end. And there's this group in the middle mm-hmm. that probably don't get as much attention.
They don't, and we're actually we're working with health right now. We're having a men's health fair in the month of June because June is Men's Health Month, and we're really targeting men in that 30 to 40 and on up age range, because if we're not a senior yet, we're all going to be seniors one day because the alternative is not that great.
No. Right, exactly.
Jane, before you go, could you back up one slide?
That would be technology. I'm sure Bob could handle
Bob
it.
Will fix you.
I'm not so sure.
Let's go.
So now, obviously, you've got a climb going on there.
Yes.
And my guess is, I don't know if you've ever had a chance to really do any forecasting or had any, you know, maybe outside help to forecast. We've heard from the MAPC study, mm-hmm. which, you know, clearly says mm-hmm. it's the fastest growing population in Reading,
yes.
and anticipated for the next 20 years. So when you look at 14 and then you look at 16, where is the delta as it grows to cause you to need more staff?
That's what we're looking at right now. And that was the purpose behind the survey. And that the survey was step one.
Yeah.
Really step one in planning for the future.
But that survey, as I recall, went out to the community, mm-hmm. not just to the senior population, correct?
Correct. So we asked adults. Really, we were targeting 40 and over to take the survey. And we offered it both on paper and online. We got a better response on paper because I think our current seniors are more vested into it or felt that. Even in my own Reading community, when I would ask folks that I know, I would get pushback, well, I'm not a senior. And so we got a lot of resistance, and I perfectly understand that. If you don't work with seniors, and you're not close to a senior, you're not thinking that, you know, we don't go through our 30s and 40s thinking, oh, I'm going to be 70 one day.
It does happen, though.
It's about to happen.
And we feel we got a good response, and when you see the rest of the data, and I should have it for you within a month.
It would be great when you put it together to cross-tabulate the responses by age, because obviously we know you're working in the trenches every day. You know what folks need who are currently seniors and struggling. I'd be curious to see what the people who are 50 mm-hmm. are thinking, that, you know, as they project forward, mm-hmm. what that's going to be. And my guess is those needs might be different, and those might be the ones we need to plan for more mm-hmm. than maybe what we already have. Although obviously, you know, you probably couldn't have enough people to take care of the SAMs yeah. here. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I'd be interested to kind of see like what the difference is in the age group responses of what people, because that shows what people are thinking about.
It does. And we worked with the MAPC in doing the survey, so I can go back to them this week and ask them to try to look at the data and analyze it from that perspective.
There's an interesting financial corollary here, too, that we really have to be mindful of. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, that thing, that bar grows where it's growing, and it's at a certain point, I'm sure you're going to be able to calculate those units as they connect to staff requirements,
mm-hmm.
And then of course, you know, the music goes round and round. You have to figure out how you're going to pay for that. So
right, and we will, as we put together the master plan, we will project that. But also, I like to keep in mind that we're not the only ship in the ocean. That we have many good partners, and I think a lot of it is to continue to grow those relationships and. You know, we do a lot of case managers partner a lot with us from Mystic Valley because we're here in the community, and a Mystic Valley case manager might get here once or twice a year, but our case manager's right here, you know, 5 days a week. So I think it's also a matter of making sure that those partnerships are strong and that there isn't someone out there that we should be partnering with that we're not. You know, really, our relationship with our CASA is fairly new, just because we weren't thinking of the substance abuse angle. And, you know, after a few conversations, you know, that relationship has become stronger, and we've actually started sharing a couple of clients with our CASA, because in some areas they are better suited to manage those types of issues.
That's great. I didn't mean to derail you.
No, that's okay.
One follow-up, and I don't want to create paralysis by analysis, but this is a measure of touches, how many times you've had to engage. Mm-hmm. You must have a measure of how many people during a year have been, how many unique individuals have been touched, and how many times a single individual has needed more than one time.
We do. I could have come in here tonight right. with nothing but charts and graphs and data.
I don't want to do that, but there might be one or two other looks mm-hmm. of the data like this, just one or two others mm-hmm. that might be interesting to take a peek at. For example, is the total population growing, mm-hmm. or is it just the intensity, the number of times during a year that mm-hmm. the population needs it? Is the population growing, or is the use intensity growing?
Mm-hmm.
What did it look like 10 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
Does that tie to the larger demographic aging of the boomers, for example?
Yep. I can get you, just if you let me know what you want for stats, I can pull those together. We do have a software program that we use, My Senior Center. We have a new component coming this summer to it. So we do track our contacts. We even categorize it, whether it's food pantry, housing, exactly. And we can look and say, we're getting a lot more requests regarding property tax issues versus food pantry issues. And so we even have it all categorized.
It's not a homework assignment as much as John's point. If you're seeing the growth, I'd be curious to know if it's more people or mm-hmm. more the same people with more needs.
Over and over.
Exactly, yeah. Right.
I do think that when we don't have such a packed agenda, I don't want to speak for you guys, but I think it would be good for you to come back maybe in the summer when we have a little bit, not quite as many things on the agenda, and to really, I think this is important information as we process towards the fall.
Mm-hmm.
And to that point, Jane, as you know, we're going to be looking at sort of, you know, the town's finances going forward, and we've scheduled a number of listening sessions out in the community. Your constituency probably tends not to go out on an evening, so if there's a way, and I would encourage you to have the whole council here, someone needs to speak. I mean, the parents of school-age children will show up, business interests will show up. Your constituency needs to show up, if not themselves, then through the council, so the SAM stories could be told, so that need is put out there. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the schedule will be posted. There's a few in June.
We do have one at the Pleasant Street Center, in the middle of the day. One of those right. listening sessions is planned.
And so I would try to get people to come out and talk about what they mm-hmm. need and what they're feeling. So mm-hmm.
it will definitely, you know, we can even put the van in service. You're more apt to get our population out in the summer months when it's still light, less so during the winter.
Yeah, I'm sure that some of your local partners would be happy to help you out with that transportation as well. You've got, you know, a list of them.
Sure, they would.
I have a couple more slides if you want to hear about the other side. That was the dramatic stuff. Also, just quick on our transportation. We have two vans now. We provide wonderful transportation. Our elder services van, the new one which we got through the Department of Transportation grant, it operates on a set route. It goes all over town to our grocery stores, our library, downtown Y. This year in Reading, up until April 30th, the van had over 6,000 trips just around Reading in the community. And it's driven close to 9,000 miles just around Reading in the community.
Does it ever leave the town, or is it all?
It goes to Walmart, and it will go to Kohl's. So those seem to be the popular spots.
Okay, is that the vehicle?
Those are the
two
vehicles.
People? I mean the counts. Are they people or vehicle trips?
Those are vehicle trips.
Okay.
So
that's different on the bottom.
Yep. The bottom is our medical transportation, and that's the Reading Response Transportation through the Hospital Trust Fund Commissioners.
Yep.
We coordinate the program for them. The service is provided through MassTran, and if someone requires a medical escort, if they're having a procedure where they need to be signed out for, Hallmark Health sends a home health aide. We found we were seeing a lot of folks weren't having their cataract surgery or their colonoscopies because they had no one to sign them out and drive them home. So Reading Response worked with Hallmark to bring in a home health aide. So now folks can have their cataract surgery. This year so far through April, we've provided 786 rides. We're averaging about 78 rides per month. On medical transportation.
That's great.
It's a great service. Then there's the Pleasant Street Center. If you haven't been lately, come on over. We've had some beautiful work done, painting, and we offer dinners. We try to do them monthly. It's tough in the wintertime, sponsored by the Council on Aging, and also Police and Fire host a dinner, Lions. Those dinners always sell out. We are permitted for 70 people. The Lions Club will be there next week for dinner. We already have a wait list of about 10 people. They always sell out, but they're really a fun event for everyone. We offer fitness 5 days a week. We have gardening. Our art class has expanded. We're actually having our own art show in June. Because we have art in multiple rooms now because they grew out of the room they were in, and we added an advanced art program. We have wonderful programs. We've had over 1,000 residents visit the center over 10,000 times for this fiscal year alone.
Wait, say that again.
We've had 1,000 seniors visit the center over 10,000 times.
10,000 visits.
10,000 visits, right. Not each. So, you know, one person may come, you know, we have some folks that come for fitness 3 days a week, and then they'll stay for lunch. So it's a lot of activity.
So
even
1,000 individual people. So in different.
1,000 individual people.
Unique in a town of 25,000.
Right.
You get four per.
We're getting about one quarter, a little under one quarter of the senior population who come into the center.
1,000 unique days.
So you estimate there's 4,000 to 5,000 seniors.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, the folks that do come by, they tend to stay. They take part in lunch or they volunteer. We offer wellness programs, really the gamut. We're always looking for suggestions from the residents and from the community as well.
Does any of the space at the library play to any of your offerings?
That has, we have really, the silver lining to the library's closing is that we got folks that might otherwise not want to come into a senior center. It really has played in. People have come for other programs and seen what a nice environment it is, and come back.
Sure.
So to us, the library closing was a bit of a boom. And we've enjoyed having the partnership with them. It's strengthened our relationship. We're actually now talking with the library about offering one of our programs at the library when they open in November. And we'll be looking to incorporate a memory cafe, which is an Alzheimer's social group. And we would be offering that at the library.
You have a lot of volunteerism. I've been able to come to your volunteer appreciation dinners. It's just kind of overwhelming how many people are there. Mm-hmm. And I mentioned something. I mean, what you and your group have done is rallied people to really let neighbors help neighbors. It's really quite heartwarming. I mean, Bob shared with me that your volunteer hours would equal two people working full-time, mm-hmm. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for 365 days. I mean, that's a staggering amount of volunteerism, which I think is really something. I mean, you really kind of engendered. I mean, you're getting a lot for a little.
We
when
do.
When you have that many volunteers.
And that's why we have a nice dinner for them every year, because yeah. we really appreciate their service.
It must be one great dinner.
Well, you'll have to come next year.
Yeah.
So we do have a lot to offer the community. You know, we like to think of ourselves as an adult community center, not so much a senior center, but really it's a community center for adults where from the younger senior right up to the older senior, we really have something for everyone. So in conclusion, our future planning and what we talked about, we've done the survey. The next phase after wrapping up the survey is that we will do a review of comparable communities, like communities, to look and see what types, their population, their staffing, their budget, what types of programs and services they're offering as well. So we can get a comparison of how we are doing compared to our peers. One of the big focuses in the coming year is looking at the way we communicate with residents through programs and services, and that would be through the website. And my lifelong dream is to get on Facebook for elder services. So we can reach those.
Careful what you wish for.
I know. Well, we need to reach the adult children that don't live in the community. We need to reach Sam's son in Arizona. I've gotten calls from Kansas. I've gotten calls from California. We need to reach those, so we need to reach them the way folks are reaching out. And that is through Facebook, and it is through website, and really, really become more savvy with social media or start using it more as we grow. Also, I talked about the center. I will tell you, it's a beautiful building. It's just gorgeous. It has special meaning, but the walls are closing in on us. Our art class has spread out across the hallway. Yoga, we've done everything we can to make more room for yoga. Even getting rid of the old TV to free up 3 feet of space so they could fit one more person in the yoga class. Our dinners sell out. Some of our special lunches are selling out. We sold out for St. Patrick's Day. There's some programs that we're not able to offer that people have asked, such as a men's fitness class. We don't have the room for it. Some programs we've had to delay. Such as Matter of Balance, we had to take a delay in it because we didn't have the space for it. Even with the library opening, lately we haven't had space for the library to run their programs because with our nurse advocate, we have more wellness programs, so we need space to run the wellness programs. So that's a major issue that we have going forward is space. And being more creative with how we use space. But the walls are the walls. And when you have, you know, 80 to 100 people who want to come for dinner and you only have seats for 70, you know, the council has the ability to fund a dinner for 100. We just don't have the space for 100. And many of you have been to the Veterans Day breakfast. Again, we're actually looking for space. Kevin Bowmiller and I have talked about looking for space outside of the center because we just can't feed that many people in such a short period of time.
And when you say sold out, you really mean fully subscribed.
Right.
People aren't buying tickets for that.
Right. They sign up. We're permitted for 70.
Yeah.
We can't fit 90 people in a room where we're permitted for 70. So it is a concern. It's, you know, I think when I talk with the Council on Aging and the council, we have met specifically and talked about space planning. We're looking at this being a problem really 2 to 3 years down the road, that we need to think about what we can do in terms of making sure we have the space for the next boom of seniors.
Okay.
Jane, speaking about space, I've been in the building upstairs a few times. Is that getting the same kind of use, or is the upstairs?
Oh, it does. Yes, it is. And that's where the library, when they first closed, they were running a lot of programs. A lot of them were upstairs. But now we're running wellness programs. We're running Matter of Balance, which is a program through Mystic Valley. They come out and run. We have a writers group. So those rooms are getting filled during the day now as well.
So it's not just getting a bigger centralized room. You need the upstairs. You need the upstairs to get larger.
If we want to run simultaneous programs, it's interesting on the days that we have days where we literally have every room has a program going on in it simultaneously.
Wow. And have you looked at, or is there an opportunity to do regionalization? Not for the reason that we wouldn't do it for, say, other functions, but maybe to get some new ideas. You're doing some of it here with idea generation, but either combining with another town to do some common activity or take advantage of a larger piece of real estate that they may have or a larger meeting room. Is there any opportunity to do some of that?
We haven't looked at going outside of town. You know, we have looked at different opportunities within the community. You know, like I had mentioned before with the Memory Cafe, we don't have the space at the center for it. So I spoke with the library about possibly offering that particular program at the library once a month. And that's something that they're willing to work in and absolutely do with us. So, you know, we've looked at different church spaces to run different programs at. The thing that we need to be very mindful of is that they do have to be fully handicap accessible with handicap bathrooms, ramps, elevators.
That's tough.
And some of the older churches closer to the center just don't meet our needs because they don't have the handicap bathrooms.
Thank you.
And then finally, last but not least, I have to say thank you for the electronic sign-in. We're getting into the 90s here. and this is the software that it's called My Senior Center, and we use it on social services to track statistics. And through the generosity of the town and town meeting, we'll now be able to put a kiosk for sign-in at the center. It's a key tag, so we'll have a rollout of it. And folks, when they come in, instead of doing a paper sign-in, they'll either be able to key tag and do a touch screen. So we'll have better tracking of attendance at programs. So we'll be able to provide better statistics in the long run. Okay. And I went way over my time.
Great job.
Okay.
Thank
you very much.
Really valuable information.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jane.
Thank you.
And thanks to you and your group for everything you're doing. So, MAPC member report.
Hey, Steve, right here.
We're back on track.
I know. Well, Arena's in town now, that's why.
Steve Sadworth is a resident of Reading and a professional, by professional planner.
Yep, correct, thank you, Bob.
And you're a liaison to MAPC, your appointment.
So I am the community development director in the town of Tewksbury, and I've been the town of Reading's MAPC rep probably, I think, the last 10 years or so. And I've been affiliated with MAPC for probably closer to 18 years when I worked in Stoneham. So just a little bit of background on the Metropolitan Area Planning Council. It is a one of 13 of the state's regional planning agencies. MAPC happens to be the largest at 103 communities centered around Boston. They run a number of different sub-regional groups, and Reading happens to be in the North Suburban Planning Council. Our member communities in that sub-region include Linfield, Wakefield, Stoneham, Woburn, Wilmington, Burlington, and Winchester. I don't think I left anybody out. So as far as an update is concerned, I have to say that I am the town's representative to MAPC, which gives, I have votes at the council meetings that they hold semi-annually. There's one coming up at the end of this month. The sub-region group meets on a monthly basis, and either myself or staff from the town are present at those meetings. And a lot of it is an update on what MAPC is doing, whether it be for the Transportation Improvement Plan, which I think everyone's aware of, helps get some federal funding into the communities. And I believe West Street was funded through that whole Transportation Improvement Plan process, the TIP process. Some of the things recently with the sub-region and MAPC here in Reading is that the town hired MAPC to work on the hazard mitigation plan, and it was drafted back in 2010 with the help of MAPC, and the town is now working with MAPC to update that plan. The group includes Julie, Jean, Bob, conservation agent, your town engineer, and assistant fire chief. So that's a service that is being provided through MAPC. The town has provided comments to MAPC regarding the TIP, the most recent TIP that's out right now. MAPC finalized the Economic Development Action Plan for the town back in December of 2015, and the town is now actively looking at ways to implement that. And I have to say that the zoning workshop that was held about a month ago, I attended, and I thought it was just an outstanding turnout. In fact, I sent Julie an email saying that I was a bit envious for what they were able to pull off. It was a really, for those that were present, it was just very well run professionally, and it actually made me proud to be a resident of Reading to see how everyone interacted with each other. The planning staff here is working on a district local technical assistance grant with MAPC right now for a detailed planning or a parking management strategy. This was something that was recommended in the economic development plan, and I think you may remember that the study was done back in 2009 with Nelson Nygaard, and the intent now is to look at a more specific strategy and as to how and where to roll out different implementation components from that study. And then, as I had suggested before, the planning staff is attending the North Suburban Planning Council meetings, and I think there's an interest to have more of a dialogue with the other eight communities to try and understand things that are working in those communities, whether they be overlay districts or different types of incentives that other communities may be using. And then I guess the last thing that I would just mention is that with town meeting's approval for the funding of the economic development planner, there will be an opportunity now to really, you know, hit the ground hard running as far as trying to implement things that came out of that economic development plan. Mm-hmm. That's great.
So, you know, you sit in meetings with some of our peer communities. When you're sitting in there and they're going around the table, do you ever have an aha moment about, we got to do that in Reading? Or do those guys do it?
Yeah.
We should do what they're doing
they
in Reading.
They do it. It's more of, they want to emulate Reading. I would like to do that in Tewksbury, but it's a very different community that I work in.
Okay. So we're on the right track then.
Yes, I believe so. Okay.
Other questions?
Thank you, Steve.
Steve, thanks.
You're welcome.
Thanks for continuing
to represent our interests there and letting us know what's going on. I appreciate it.
It's my pleasure.
Are we missing anything from them? I mean, we've used the MAPC a lot.
Yeah. No. And I like I was saying, I've been involved with MAPC for probably about 18 years, and I think the services that they're providing today are just 10 times better than what was there a decade or so ago. They're really trying to reach out and help communities, and I think Reading's doing a very good job as far as aligning our planning needs with the resources that MAPC has available.
I just have a quick question.
Yeah.
Is there any effort to be working more regionally between towns?
Is that
just too optimistic?
What specifically? I mean, as far as shared services or?
Just in terms of objectives. We have common borders with several communities around us. We don't work together much on these issues. In many other disciplines, we talk a lot more often, police, fire, water, sewer, engineering, but planning not so much.
Yeah, I think from a
other than regionally.
Right, and there hasn't been a lot of that type of conversation. Again, from my own experience in Tewksbury, we have an economic development opportunity with the former Raytheon plant. The problem is that the border with Billerica cuts right through a 500,000 square foot building. So we're starting to talk with Billerica now about how we can kind of align our zoning with theirs, so that when it comes to trying to permit that property, it would be much easier and smoother, because it's dealing with two different conservation commissions,
yeah,
two different planning boards. It's just
it can be daunting.
Yeah. So I think what they're, when the opportunities present themselves, planners are very smart people, so they will look for opportunities where they can do that. But
okay,
they need the support of the towns that they work for.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you. Good job. And how are we doing? We're a little behind. RCTV.
Not too bad. Kathy.
Steve.
I'm hobbling a little. Sorry.
Steve,
you're doing good.
Don't
boot.
Steve, help.
Don't boot.
That's great.
Steve, you know your way around. Come on.
Thank you. Hi, my
Hello.
Name is Kathy Crook.
How are you?
I brought with me several people from the board and staff. I have Phil Rustworth, Angela Merrill, and Kevin Vent from staff, and John Carpenter, Steve Goldie, Catherine Robertson, and Jake McLear. They're all on the board with me. So did you get?
I was just going to find that video for you.
Okay.
Would a presentation be without a video for once?
Yeah. It is RCTV. So I kind of wanted to do three different things: where we are now, or where we've been, where we are now, and kind of like where we're going. So,
yep.
Oh,
look at
that
guy.
Voice.
Oh, we better start over. We don't want to cut Gene out.
So can you talk about the role that the school committee has in town?
Sure. Our town has a lot of boards, committees, and commissions, but most of them are actually dictated by local bylaw or by our town charter.
Determine what kind of cuts would have to be made.
Well, first of all, just a little very quick, because I only have 2 minutes, about sort of how our budget gets constructed every year.
Yeah, it seems like pretty much, unless everybody in Representative 28 voted against it, that it seems like it's likely that that's going to be the case. And so we're getting ready here just to take a look at a few of the numbers that we have.
Kindergarten all the way through middle school.
Okay.
It's pretty neat. The gentlemen that run the program for us, Jim Murphy and Carl McFadden, a lot of people know them.
And now it gives me great pride to present to you the Reading Memorial High School Class of 2015.
And then that failure at life, Beatrice, continued to pretend she didn't know it was me. But it was clear from her false accusations that she absolutely knew it was me.
Dude, why'd you text her in the first place?
Because I didn't have Cleo's number and I needed to get my anger out on someone. And technically she is the source of my anger, spreading lies like that.
What lies?
That I like her? Why else would Cleo say that?
I'm here at the Reading Fall Street Fair with Karen Sawyer Guzzi. Karen, talk about this day so far.
Well, it's been a great day. It's always a great day here at the Reading Fall Street Fair.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Old Reading Butcher Shop. My friend Tom and I are going to talk turkey today.
Thin, nice. And very cradle. Muscular. There it is.
There's a quick pin. Consistent.
Nice. Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
We can't argue with it. There you go, John O'Brien.
Hello, children, and welcome back to Storytime with Winnie and Nan. This is Winnie, and I'm Nan. And the theme for today's show is all about winter. Dappled deer wander, making no sound. They rest closely knit.
And also we want to thank especially Lou and Elaine from Mandarin in Reading. And what if we made here today? Because I know this was the California monkey roll.
Yeah.
And these were the special...
spinach wrap.
Spinach wrap.
Sushi.
And here we have the...
And it's very fluffy, and it makes for a nice soft candy cane as opposed to something very, very hard that sticks to your teeth. Once we remove it from the hook, we bring it back to the table just to form it into a loaf that's workable for the candy cane.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. There! And there you have it. The lights have gone on.
All around the common. It's gorgeous.
To thank you for watching. We'll be back in just a moment here on RCTV.
Although the election coverage for 2015, which was live, and that was when the machine broke and things had to be done manually, was very long. I'm not sure Kevin or Katie would say that was fun.
Wasn't fun for the candidates either.
So I wanted to add, though, something that you're going to be very familiar with. From January to present, the meeting coverage for the Board of Selectmen, Town Meeting, School Committee has been 62.5 hours. Of meeting coverage. Now I know most of you have been at most of those. Last year in the same time frame it was 39.5. So there's been a really big difference.
We're doing our best to make the meetings longer.
Well, we thank you for that. And then there were 14.
I think that was last week.
We had 14 hours of 40B meetings already this year that didn't have last year. And there's been 9 meetings at the Pleasant Street Center, 1 at Parker, the 2 town meetings at RMHS. So we're getting, we're getting around where we're conversing with the town to make sure that we have not cable.
Fiber.
In all the places so that we can broadcast from there more readily. So that's kind of where we've been, where we are. I mentioned a little bit about the fiber, the library community, the new community room. We're working on design so that we're going to have kind of a mini studio there. Cameras, switchers, all those things that I don't know anything about. We've increased conversations with the both John Doherty and Chuck Robinson about what it would look like to get back into the schools, and we've had those conversations over the past few weeks as well. We're currently are continuing to add new shows, getting new people interested in producing their own stuff. Winnie and Nan is an example, who, you know, she just started last fall and said, I have this idea, I'm retired and I want to do something, and walked right in. The summer programs are the screenplay that you saw part of the video was a program that kids acted in and did all the technical stuff. So we're trying to combine the theater aspect, people who enjoy acting, and say, you know, there's this film available. And this year we've expanded it from 2 weeks to three. And then we, as a board, just recently did a, just actually Saturday, so we're still mulling over some of the stuff, but a retreat, kind of a strategic planning, where are we going, what are we doing, and how are we going to get there. So we're still working on that process, but as a board, you know, we've come together to do that. And where we're going. So this one's a little interesting. So we have RCTV organization night again. I'm quite sure that you've heard about it. And we have our annual meeting. And I have little flyers to invite you with, if you could take one and pass it, which is May 19th. So we do the annual meeting, the full annual report, that sort of thing. A little bit of ice cream thrown in, and then we start the 72-hour film festival, which will be our third annual one, where teams have 72 hours to write, film, edit, and a 7 minute, no more than 7 minutes?
Two to seven minute long
short film. And then we do kind of a, you know, a premiere type of showing of it and vote on them. So that's the real current stuff. As far as a little bit longer, we are planning for the upcoming contracts, whether it's the one with the town or the town, you know, with Verizon and Comcast. We have attended informational conferences, workshops, Mass Access, has had workshops, they've had people in. We've communicated, had conversations with other towns that are in the middle of it. How's it going? What are they giving to you? Are they mean? Are they, you know, that sort of thing.
Yes.
Mean is probably the good answer. And then the Alliance, we're a member of the Alliance for Community Media. Their conference, national conference, is actually in Boston this year, August 18th to 20th. And they have tracks on negotiations, as you know, so that you can come and listen, hear what are other towns doing.
When is that?
August 18th to 20th. And there isn't, but if anyone is interested to go to any part of that, let Phil or myself know, and we'll pay the admission fee. Because I think it's really important so that you know, kind of, you know, it's different than it was 10 years ago. And there's a lot of resources out there. It's interesting because the woman who did our retreat this weekend is actually in Brookline, and I went to the Alliance for Community Media show last year, or conference last year, and my one goal was to find an outside person to run our retreat, and I did, and we were in Pasadena, but she's from Brookline, so we went down, saw their facility as well, and there are a couple of other names out there that, you know, just are really helpful, and you know, we want this to be this endeavor over the next 30 months or 29, I'm not sure where the countdown is, to be as successful for both of us. So, yes.
A couple questions. Can you, one of the areas that seems the most ripe for further involvement would be and you had some of it here, but maybe you could say a few more words on coverage of high school athletics, either as a formalized program where the kids participate in taking the videos or any other fashion that you've got. I see you're doing kind of spontaneous things around certain sports.
Can I? Yes.
Yeah, we've been talking about that internally for the last 6 or 7 months, I would say. And our plan going forward is to have a meeting with the, I think he's now an assistant principal at the high school who runs the athletic program, and to talk with him about developing parent groups to do that. That's what Pop Warner does. Pop Warner has a kind of this rotating group of parents who will learn how to use the cameras, come and take them, and cover Pop Warner. If you've seen the channel with Pop Warner, you know, it's heavily covered. so we would like to be working with the boosters clubs and what have you at the high school to be able to develop parent groups and kind of a rotating group of parent groups who would be covering whatever sport that they want to be involved in.
That'd be huge. I can't tell you, you know, in this day and age, kids have more technology in their pocket than existed 20 years ago
right. In
the whole school system. And there's a real opportunity, maybe it is at the parent level. I was thinking even at the senior level, there might be enough interest either from a production point of view or whether that you'd get enough coverage of an entire season. Football runs to mind. Baseball's a little tougher because of the venue, but maybe you can do that too. Wrestling's kind of easy. It's indoors. But that's one. The other is there any today formalized program, credit earning program with the school around? You talked about a couple of those, you know, 7-minute films and the example that was on the video, but is there anything that's an entire semester that covers the entire pre-production, post-production, that's been tied up with the school in terms of credit? Somebody going to communication school, somebody going to broadcasting school, even somebody going to some unrelated school, that's a great public speaking experience for somebody to get into and kind of learn what it's like to be behind a camera and be comfortable. It'd just be interesting to build that into the curriculum of the high school. I'm not sure that's practical, but it seems like it's such a nugget of in the town. We gotta find a way to exploit that at the school level as well.
What we do currently have going on is we have the Rocket Independent Video Club. So it's an after-school club that meets. So we
right.
do get a lot of kids who have personal interest in that can do that. But when the change of everything sort of happened at the high school, that's when we sort of fell out of the high school, which is what we're trying to work back,
yep.
is getting into the high school. We'd also love to get into the middle schools as well, you know, because there are kids at that age that eat it up. But also what we do is we work with the high school for independent programs. So they can come to us for internships, and so they can get, so that is at the credit level, so that they can come to us and they'll work for a full semester. And they come in, it's sort of towards the end of the day. They usually schedule for them since they're leaving the high school that they'll do it the last couple of periods of the day. So they usually show up to us at about 1:30, 2 in the afternoon, work for a few hours each day. So they're getting the talent communication skills if that's what they want to get. They're also getting some business admin skills because some, you know, want to get sort of both pieces. They don't necessarily know is, you know, TV or film something that they want to tackle, but so they're getting sort of that working in a business type setting. So we do offer what we can right now. We are in talks, like Kathy had said, about getting ourselves back into the school. And like I said, you were mentioning the technology in their pocket. That's why we'd really love to get our hands on middle school as well and not just high school, because what we get a lot of coming in the summer and after school is middle school age kids who really want to learn how to create TV shows, make movies, film, all that, be in front of the camera as well, because that's just as important as being behind the camera. So we're really trying to engage in all of those aspects and bring them in. And that's sort of one of the cool things that we've developed with the 72-hour film fest, is that they come in, they don't have to be a member of RCTV to come to RCTV for the weekend and work on this film, submit it. It's a contest, so in the end, you know, there are winners, and we do a big screening night for everybody, regardless of, you know, whether they were the winners or not. So we're doing what we can at the time, and we are currently trying to get back into the school system.
That really triggered a thought. Would you ever think about putting a small studio at the schools, letting the kids go with it, let them, you know, give them the equipment, give them the backdrop, and let them go produce a show of their own making?
Yep, it's just the space at the school. If we
can. That used to exist when I went to school. Ironically, the old high school, which had less technology, had the services on site, and it was not built into the school when it was rebuilt. And so, unfortunately, the program that existed when I went to school no longer exists, and so we are not able to currently do a school credit. But certainly the board is more than open to that conversation.
Yep.
I think there would be some logistics that go into it, but it's certainly something that we would like to entertain.
That's where you talk to Verizon and you make that part of the deal. Cover on some fiber.
Well,
right?
We don't necessarily need to wait for the contract renegotiation. There is potential in our budget now to enable that. I think, you know, we've had conversations with Bob and some folks about the logistics of what that might look like, and if there truly is interest, I think we could.
So it sounds like you need space.
Yeah. I'm sorry?
It sounds like you need space.
Space and
I mean, it sounds like you have
logistics.
The will.
Well,
sounds
teacher.
Like you may have the budget.
A teacher as well.
The other issue that was kind of referenced that you may not be clear was when the high school changed their schedule to be staggered so that every day is different, that made coordination with offering a class almost impossible. If you had, you know, third period C block every day, that would work for offering this.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been one of the biggest stumbling blocks for the high school, and they've at least discussed going to a different schedule next year or the year after.
Mm-hmm. That's because there needs to be consistency at the RCTV side?
If they wanted to have a teacher available, well, on Thursday you're going to work from 11 in the morning to 12, and then on Tuesday, it's just a wacky schedule for one teacher to teach a class like that.
It had currently been a part-time position, so if we could work out some sort of logistics of creating a full-time position, that might create a way to make that bouncing schedule more doable.
And on the space issue, you don't need any. You could have a dual use space. You could use the auditorium stage with a backdrop, right? On an as needed basis.
Not clear. They might need their own space.
Anything's possible. We're talking to the superintendent about it.
Yeah.
We're
trying to find a space and how we work out the teaching.
Cool. Good. Thank you.
Anything else?
Actually, it's serendipity. As Kathy, you were speaking. I just got a text from my wife that my son was accepted to a pre-college residential program at Emerson College this summer based on the work and his portfolio that he learned at RCTV. So that summer program works. And if there's ways that you can expand it, get more kids involved, the stuff you're teaching him is fabulous. So
tell Jake, we said congrats.
Other questions?
Okay.
Kathy, I'd just like to also thank you for making yourself available to me over the course of the last month or so. We've had a chance to meet and kind of talk about opening a great line of communication between what you, your board, and the team there is doing and how that connects to the Board of Selectmen. I'd like to thank you for
Well, you're welcome. I've enjoyed it as well.
Thanks, everyone.
Okay.
Actually, we're not so bad.
Do
you want to take 2 minutes, John, or not?
Just good.
I can.
I don't know.
Am I going to be accused of something?
Well, you've got 20 minutes, then I can fill any amount of it, because at 9 you're going to want to do hearings.
Right.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do a very brief recess.
I would have waited, had I not.
For the old guys in the room.
Yeah.
Elbow it, everybody.
That's the mantra of the evening, the last one.
In theory, regionalization opportunities will exist all the time. But I can tell you right now, and what community services has been through is a really interesting example. I'll be really quick. To regionalize elder human services was discussed with several towns around us 2 to 3 years ago. And from what I could gather, a much better solution in Reading was to regionalize within community services and have things like multi-generation events between recreation and the senior population. The senior services we provide are light years ahead of most of our peers around us.
Okay.
So as Steve Sadwick mentioned, we can always be helping our community's partners and educating them.
Yeah.
But we don't get a lot back, quite honestly, in that relationship. And if you want to share staff, that works fine. But in terms of volunteerism, Reading's ahead. So it really works out better that we do a better job internally within our borders on this issue. And from speaking to the mayors and managers, you know, senior services and social services don't port across borders very well. That's just one of the things it doesn't.
You say senior services don't?
Right. You know, we discussed with another community sharing a larger senior center. They have a small one, we have a small one. We could bus people back and forth. They won't go.
They don't want to cross the jurisdictional lines.
Border. Yeah. You know, they've done surveys, we've done surveys.
We're very tribal. Go to Walmart, but that's as far as we're going.
Right? Yeah, exactly.
It's part of the annexation process.
You're on this thing.
In terms of the area relationships, you know, some of the selectmen know full well. We've been working with North Reading and Wakefield, especially on two issues, night and day, and we're doing a nice job. School-town integration, I think we've pretty much hit what we can hit.
Mm-hmm. You think there's more there, Bob, that you can see?
The area we have not really touched is finance. Once upon a time, 10 years ago, the schools did not have a business manager. Our town accountant did that work, which is probably not a real good use of the town accountant's time.
Sure.
But it was more centralized. So John and I have talked about it. His needs are very specialized within the school function. They really need a full-time person.
Right.
Is there some synergy to be gained? I don't really know. We talked about combining technology staffs. Instead, they're working closely together. You don't notice a difference now. They can buy stuff for 10 cents on the dollar. We have to pay a dollar. So like there's reasons to keep it separate. HR, we're sharing a position, and John Doherty actually swung by today in town hall and just wanted to make sure everyone knew that that was working out really, really well, that everyone in the schools really liked the fellow that we hired. We happen to have an interview, John and I, today for assistant facilities director. Facilities are working out great.
Yes.
Everyone in the schools in town are very happy about that. So that's worked as well as you could hope. The next group, John Feudo is the chair. Public-private partnerships, you know, Jane did a pretty nice summary of that. There's a lot going on that doesn't get a lot of publicity, and that's the usual story and the usual theme around here. My guess is that a lot of folks didn't know all those organizations were part of Human Elder Services in Reading. I didn't know all of it. There were some names on the list that were new to me. You know, as usual, marketing is kind of where we fall a little bit short. They have conducted the survey. They have not yet fully done a master plan for their needs in the future, as the Board of Health has done. They're just about a year behind them, but they're on a good path. They expect to have that done, probably not for the fall, so it wouldn't be part of a discussion, if you will, community-wide, other than anyone knows demographics are suggesting if Reading wants to continue to provide the level of services to seniors they are today, it's going to require more dollars and more staffing just based on demographics, period.
Yeah.
That's clear. In terms of performance measurement, there we've done one thing well and one thing not well. We've really not suggested new ways to gather data or measure performance, other than we really have dug in on those peer communities. You saw some of that in the budget presentation in January and then at town meeting. There is a lot more financial data available through the state that I hadn't been aware of fully before. And although it's not perfect, it's not bad. It's much better than it was 10 years ago. The school peer community data has always been far better than the town. The town side's catching up. The Bureau of Local Services at the state level is doing a much better job, so we've tried to use that. And again, the peer community approach, I think the schools and the town now, you know, believe it's very helpful. The schools are willing to go to, we have 22 communities as FinCom policy. We had a consultant add three communities, so now we're at 25. There's some debate about that. The schools are at 30, so they use our 25 and they like five more. So we have a lot more now in common, but it's still not exactly the same. And whether or not that needs to change, I don't know. When you're dealing with 22 or 25 or 30, the law of large numbers says it's okay. It doesn't really matter. There's no difference. Under communications, Matt has done a great job.
Some of it you're just now starting to see. The new website's really good. It's especially good because it now works on your smartphone and pretty much any device you can create. And in the past, it was horrible at that. We've got some applications that'll now roll out now that we have this new format and people can use them on their smartphone.
Bob, is that just the surface layer, or does it go deeper than that?
Everything was redone. The whole thing was redone. So it took a lot, and the trouble is you have a website that's live.
Yeah,
you have to sort of take it offline for 3 or 4 weeks. So we really did struggle to keep things up to date for 3 or 4 weeks, and you know now it's starting to go again. I'll tell you, there's a lot of work to do. There's so much information on that website. Some of it is definitely out of date and incorrect. We just need to find it. We keep looking at, you know, every day or two we look.
Yeah. How are we doing content management on that to keep things fresh?
That's the biggest challenge, is every department needs to take ownership of something.
They do.
Some do better than others. It's pretty obvious as you go through different sections. You know, police and fire, police especially do a really nice job. Fire will catch up now that they have an assistant.
Is it an easy process for them? They don't need to know technology to do that?
I haven't been trained. They refuse to let me know.
Okay.
So I think it's not bad, because they said I would be capable of learning if they would let me near it. So I don't think it's bad, and I believe we still have the ability, and I have the interest in letting some of the boards and committees take care of themselves. You want to be careful about that, though, because they are an arm of the government, so you want to have at least an approval process,
that
but they could be creative and do things.
But we're posting minutes of all,
stuff. For instance, this right here is the Selectmen's packet. It's in our Leisure Free Center document storage already.
Good.
Available through the website.
I wonder if there's some kind of, there must be some kind of program, well, Facebook certainly has it, where if you, for example, if you tag me in a conversation, it goes right to my account, lets me know that you've tagged me, and keeps it offline until I actually approve it. There must be some kind of mechanism where these boards can do that.
Okay.
And it tags Matt and says, hey,
that's
the Town Forest Committee just put up a posting for your review before it goes live.
Kevin. Very good.
We have that exact thing in Munis.
Okay.
We have an approval process. The exact same thing is available through the website, pretty much as you described.
Okay.
We decide
great.
What the approval process is. Matt is probably the most logical person. So, yeah.
Okay, great.
It will exist. Let's see. Board and committee communication. That's really a discussion I still need to have with you, I believe. You know, what do we want to accomplish? What do we want to achieve? We now have the tools and the foundation there. We can now sit down and discuss what is it that you think needs improving. We had discussed last summer or last fall having a summit of some sort with chairs and vice chairs. Okay, that's easy enough to plan. Well, not that easy, but we'll figure it out. But what do we say? What do we want to do? We really need to discuss content, and that's a discussion I think we all still need to have.
Yeah.
Well, I think our listening sessions over the next few months will probably inform a lot of that content. So.
Well, that'll tell us about where the citizens are coming from, but this particular piece is something that we've been laboring over for a couple of years now, how to get the boards and committees to coordinate and kind of, they all have a different mission, of course, but the consistency of how they do business and how we report back and forth to each other, I think is, I think a lot of these are listed as your goals, Bob. But some of these kind of lay at our feet. Most of this stuff can't be done by the town manager. It has to be, you know, a collaborative effort, I think.
If you think of volunteerism and the boards and committees, to me, that's grassroots, that's bottom-up. That's pure bottom-up.
Yeah.
You're now talking about layering a top-down control over that. So that's hard. You know, that's a challenging thing right there, because it's going against the flow. But if you want to coordinate communications and, you know, pull everyone in the same direction, that's the only way to do it.
Do you have a way today to actually, through mailing lists, message all the members of boards, committees, and commissions?
Mm-hmm. Town meeting, same deal.
That's awesome.
We don't love the technology we use, but, you know, there's better technology, but we have a way to do that. C-Click Fix, DPW uses it. Matt uses it extensively now as ombudsman, so that's not necessarily available to the public, all his interactions, but he tracks it, so it's much like a work order system, you know, much like you saw for the senior center.
Right.
Matt uses it. So we're exploring different uses of it. The 911 evaluation,
I'm not the expert at that, but we have Everbridge. We have it up for renewal next November. The police chief and a couple others, Matt, and a couple others are looking at it. I think we're likely to make a change, quite honestly, so I hope they're listening and give us a better deal. But it was never really what it was marketed as. It really is an emergency management system, period, like Code Red.
Right.
It was marketed as many other things, which we could have used, which it really has fallen short. So if, you know, obviously we need an emergency management system. If that's what we want, just get that, do that, find another way to take care of some of this other business, see Click Fix being one way. That's the thing about technology. You know, when Kevin was in here giving you a presentation, one of the things he stressed is flexibility. You build what you have today, but you have to be able to ready to go in any direction. You can't be married to any one thing, because you know, you don't know what's going to happen next year, but you know it's going to be different.
And you're fairly certain that this is, you know, what you've got today is overcome by events. There are other options out there.
For emergency management, not very good. But for the other promises and the bells and whistles they had, yes, there are other options. For instance, for subscribers to, you know, say I'm interested in the agenda, the minutes of these boards and committees, that system was supposed to do that. It never did it well. We can now do that through the website. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, there's other tools. Mm-hmm. For strategic planning, we've got the Economic Development Action Plan completely done. As Steve mentioned, the Hazard Mitigation Plan is underway. Staff, Jesse Wilson was about halfway through that when she left, so we decided we better outsource the rest of that. And then we haven't done anything, and I really haven't brought this to your attention. I'm not sure at what point it's a good idea to form a master planning committee. It's due every 10 years. It's about 10 years now. It's either 10 or 11. I don't remember. I don't really know where it fits in because you're doing so many other plans.
Yeah.
Right.
Should you have done that first? Well, it's too late for that. Do you wait till the end? Do you do it in the middle? I don't know. We've discussed that with Gene. And we figure the economic development planner is much more important than this right now.
Yeah.
So let's just push that aside for, you know, another 6 months.
In many ways,
we're doing the zoning and you're looking at all that stuff. Anyway,
yeah, you're almost doing this by piecemeal, and at the end, you might just formally address this,
but
tie the bow on everything.
Yeah. I think we kind of made that decision about a year ago, anyway, as a group.
Yeah.
We wanted to stay nimble and aggressive when it came to economic development and look at a variety of things other than lock it into, you know, an ad hoc committee or a standing committee till we felt like we were ready. I mean, that.
Right. Yeah. Real estate, some of this I shouldn't share in public, but Paula got a call today. The post office is going to move. Is it around July 4th? They're going
to
open the new post office. Okay. So they will be across the street at Eastern Bank where we pointed them to several years ago. I'm familiar with the person who is purchasing the post office location. The last discussion I had with them, dealing with Washington is very complicated. But they have made some progress and no murders or suicides have happened so far, so that's progress. It's not been easy at all to deal with the feds. You're all aware of the 40B and the train depot situation, and you know we'll hope to have some progress on that in the next month. Downtown parking is about to come around to you. Steve mentioned they're doing a small parking analysis, piecemeal. At some point, the board's going to have to philosophically address the question of, do you want paid parking or not in downtown? Do you want a garage or not? I will tell you the conclusions reached several years ago are generally still true. There's not an insufficient amount of parking in the downtown. It's not where people want it.
Yeah.
People need to share it more and they need to be willing to walk more. It's not where they want it. If they want to go to one place, they want a parking spot within 10 feet. Otherwise, I'm not parking it behind CVS to cross the main street.
Does that item also include looking at how we've deployed different areas of parking around the depot?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I think when
merchant, commuter, that kind of thing.
Yeah, I think the 40B is kind of an important piece of this juncture. Whether it does or doesn't fly has a big impact on parking.
Yeah.
If it does, I think that's the signal to the board. Okay, now we got to look at the parking in the whole area: Haven Street, downtown, South Main Street. Let's just look at it all. You've got different zones, different 2-hour parking generally across most of it. I think the sentiment in the business community, if I could summarize it simply, is longer than 2 hours is better. You know, if you're down for one appointment, 2 hours is enough. We want you to stay.
Yeah.
But then some businesses say, well, no, I want turnover. Right. So it's the old, you know, there's no real solution. But I think the majority now are leaning towards longer, just so, so you're aware.
We're looking at kiosks, time parking. Is that part of the current
consideration? You know, one of the trends nationally is more expensive central parking. Even Winchester has that locally. The closer you are to the downtown, it actually costs you more. If you park further away, it's free or it's very cheap.
So let the market decide.
Yeah. Yeah. So let the market price it. I don't personally think the community is ready for that, but you know, that is happening in other parts of the country.
Let's see. We're down on the priority development. We've got those four PDAs all lined up. Recreation improvements. I'm having a lunch later this week with, you know, some possibilities. I have to tell you, with the financial condition of Reading, that recreation improvements are much lower on my list. They just are. You know, we'll get the field lighting, we'll get the Birch Meadow plan done, but in terms of expanding recreation, we had talked about a couple of areas, such as the old water treatment plant being maybe a field someday. I just don't see any bandwidth to go there right now, although recreation does drive revenues in. Public Works facility, we have a new business administrator with a media background. She's really good at communications. We've had a couple meetings. We had a meeting with Congressman Moulton's staff last week. The two most perfect people that he could have possibly sent were there to deal with the issues we have. So we're really optimistic that we're going to make a lot of progress in the next 6 months to come to a point where we can say yes or no on a DPW location. And just so you're aware, the Permanent Building Committee had a meeting last night to discuss the cemetery garage. Mm-hmm. They have, as they discussed at town meeting, narrowed it to two cemeteries, not including the current one. That's out.
Yep.
Bill Brown, as a representative of the Board of Cemetery Trustees, would tell you he's very happy with the work they've done there, that he's done, they've done, and he's right behind them. So his mind is completely changed on what he thought should happen. Right. Mm-hmm. They've done such a thorough
That's
job.
That's great. That's great.
However, six abutters showed up last night. So now, all of a sudden, and as I try to explain to them, pretty much every commercial piece of property other than Walker's Brook in Reading has an abutter, has a neighbor, has an impact. Almost no matter where a cemetery garage is built, is going to have an impact on someone. So they understand that, but they just wanted to know why they weren't included yet. And we explained that it's so early in the process that no decisions are even close to being made. You know, we showed them a timeline where they're going to be notified in September and have public hearings and so forth. But it was just, it was good that they came in because it reminded the Permanent Building Committee, there's people, there's neighbors.
Oh, real people. Oh, yeah.
So, you know, they had done a spreadsheet that said, well, 35% of our waiting has to be impact on neighbors. But when the neighbors actually show up, 35 enough?
Yeah. Well, they're new.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So that was good.
They haven't been beaten around the ears yet.
Library building project is, what did I write, Huff Puff?
Yeah.
It's going to finish. It's going to finish on budget, and it may have casualties along the way.
Gotta make it. It is very tough.
Just so you're aware, our construction supervisor resigned from the whole business a week or two ago. Not ours, but the contractor. Oh. So he is so sick of the business, he just walked away.
Okay.
So, you know, it's their job to fill in, and they have, and they will. And they'll get it done. But
our project manager?
He's fine. No, he's good. He's and the other, the general contractor.
Yeah. Oh, the guy's
built. The guy running the project finally just threw his hands up and said, I'm done. For whatever his reason. You know, maybe he didn't like me. I don't know.
We can go a lot of directions with that.
Yeah. So the project, no question, is going slower than it needs to go to be done on time. It should, on time meant April. It is clearly not done in April.
The poor Cashier roof.
We have projected formally and legally with documentation June 1st or June 10th, somewhere in there. There's no way that's going to happen. So we're going to have to extend it again. And you're going to hear all this next week at the Library Building Committee meeting. I don't have a date, but I've just tried to keep my patience and say it's more important to do it right than do it in a hurry. So I'm just trying to keep reminding myself that. You know, we've talked to Danis, we can extend the temporary lease. you know, everything just costs money. Okay, we have the money. If someone's responsible for the delay, they're going to help pay for it. It's much more important not to just say, okay, just slap the rest together. Because that's why we've gotten in the mess we've gotten right. so many times.
Yeah, in other situations, yep.
Are we still dealing with contingencies, or is this just work going slower?
We have money. We still have extra. We still have contingency. They're just not putting bodies on the site. They're billing us at $600,000 a month. They should be billing at $1.2 million, $1.4 million. So the work, for whatever the reason, and it's not generally weather. The pace is too slow. It's bodies on the site.
They're opening up more sites.
Yeah, they're busy. They're doing other projects. That's all it is.
Well, I mean, they know that they...
But they're financially, they're next on the line because they've got a date, June 1st. Anything beyond that, they work for free. And we have liquidated damages. So we'll figure it out. But, you know, I give Joe Huggins a lot of credit. He's being a facilities director, and this is probably half to two-thirds of his job some weeks. It's not been easy. Oakland Road, I don't know. It is in town council's lap. They know that we want to have the ability to sell it at next November town meeting. Doesn't mean you will, but I want to give you that option.
Yep.
I'm still assuming we've got that targeted. Well,
are the obstacles that big that we're even doubting we can do November?
I'm doubting it because when I mentioned to the engineers that this is going to happen and they said that was fine, then they came back in a few days and said, well, there are some loose ends that the engineers have to still tie up. So I just ripped my hair out at that point and said, all right, I don't really know what they are. So we'll see. You know, we did appoint, we have a town engineer that retired. We appointed a new town engineer starting next Monday. This is one of his jobs. Much as we like to think the zoning project is done, it isn't. The November town meeting will be at least six nights, maybe eight. Just to prepare you all. There's 15 to 20 bylaws. There's general bylaws. There's zoning bylaws.
Depending on spelling and height.
And depending on that, there's any dogs or bees or chickens.
We're flattening his tires.
That'll add time.
Getting time.
The signed bylaw discussion could go on for two nights all by itself.
Yeah.
So we'll see.
Oh, they're going to have sign ready for the fall?
Yeah. They're shooting for that. Wow. So yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
When does
again,
that begin?
Again, general bylaws.
The end of your year there.
Yeah, yeah. I don't have any time.
General bylaws, same thing. You heard an update from Steve, and we had some ideas. There's about a half dozen, and there could be more bylaws, general bylaws, going at November town meeting. And then I would like to get back and sit down with a couple of you and talk about selectmen's policies. You know, it's the last thing anyone kind of wants to do. One of my options is to give it to town council and say, what in here is not legal?
Yeah.
That's going to cost money and time. You know, I'll try to sit down with John and maybe one other of you and try to figure out what's the low-hanging fruit here that needs to be looked at. And I'll tell you, there are some selectmen's policies that have not been looked at in 25 years. Yeah. And I know they're not appropriate or applicable. And there are some town manager policies the same way. We have so many policies in this place. And we don't follow them all because we don't even remember. We have the policy. So why do we have it? This is a discussion Gene and I have about every 2 days.
Shocking. Government and too many rules?
Yeah.
How does that go together?
Yeah, I said to her, what if we just decided to delete all the rules today? All of them. All right, not general bylaws, not zoning bylaws. There's no more town manager policies. We've got to keep the porta potty one. But other than that, none. And then as there is a need, we'll develop new ones. Why is that so bad? She didn't really have a good answer other than that's not the way government works.
Well, maybe we could do some work on the side with that.
I think we should. Gene and Matt and I have sat down four times and talked about different sections of the selectmen's policy, so we have a rough draft and some ideas. But this really does require the selectmen to be interested in doing this, because I can't suggest, well, I can suggest, but I can't
decide.
Well,
we're gonna have a busy summer and fall.
And you've got other more important things, quite honestly. This is not a high priority. But
does it lend itself to kind of going at it?
Does it
lend itself to going at it, you know, 15 to 30 minutes in every week and kind of going
well,
at it?
Well, it does. I keep pushing off things on your agenda like Section 1 or Section 2. You can't handle it piecemeal. There's a lot of stuff that's standalone. Most of it's not that interesting, though. But, yeah, you could. Probably you need an hour. for a given agenda. If you want to start from scratch, have a no preliminary discussion, and finish it, it's going to take an hour. If you spread it over a couple of meetings, you could do it two shorter ones. Because some of it is going to be philosophical questions of what you believe.
What we've noticed is, and I'm not suggesting that we would hire town council to do this, because I don't think we should be spending that kind of money, but, you know, there have been a couple of bylaws that we've asked him. We know they were a mess. And he'd look at them and, you know, he'd come back with some recommendations, and it short-circuited maybe hours of discussion. Now, I can't speak for how that ended up at town meeting, but, you know, I mean, maybe that kind of a process where the five of us would take turns with you, if you could, you know, put up with us that way. And
I think
maybe
so.
We could put some, you know, we could clean them up in a way that proposals then come back to the body and into the public setting. And
alternatively, does the MMA publish model policies for select?
That's a good question. I never thought.
And maybe we just backfit any special stuff we have into those.
I don't know.
It just sounds weird that we have policies we don't follow, but we're talking about.
We have policies that we don't even know about.
That we're not going to review.
They have 2 inches
and
of dust
we're not going to review them. Just
exactly.
Something.
I know it's wrong.
It doesn't make sense.
We got to fix it.
I mean, I'm in the camp, not quite of throwing everything out, but you might say, let's bin it into one of three buckets. It goes, it stays, or it goes to Ray to kind of reformulate it.
Yeah.
And that might be a quick way to get through it.
Well, one real quick way is you go over them all and you raise your hand if you ever heard of this or used it.
Yeah.
Paul is the best judge. If she hasn't seen it in the last 10 years, guess what?
Done.
Yeah.
Let's wrap up with internal operations. You know, we have a really good idea of staffing. That's all set. You know, what we can afford to do, we'll see. And we're still kicking around the idea with HR about reviewing all town contracts to prepare for the next round of negotiations. We may or may not do that.
That'll be
a year from June. Well, we have to negotiate contracts starting next December.
Is that Labor Council that would do that?
Yes.
Okay.
Communication, I think that's wrapped into the website. I think we're in really good shape, actually. Library services, they finally completed their plan in January or so. You know, you guys have seen it. And then the last one is the discussion we're having now. You know, I realized from a discussion with the superintendent this morning at breakfast that I need to really sit down and spend a lot more time thinking about specifics of finance, of what will we do, what won't we do, what does it cost? Because he's done a good job of that on his side, and I really haven't done that yet. I have the overview and the models for all of us to think about, but I haven't focused in on the town government piece and what it is, like Jane. What does it cost to do what she just described and what she will need? I don't really know. I got to do that. As a community, and you are going to need to know what are our options. And
well,
schools
you know,
have done a better job of that.
Sooner than later, we're going to need to map out a plan of what we would do.
Yeah.
Whether it's, you know, as you come to the decision tree, it's what would you do if it's decision A, what would you do if it's decision B? And, you know, it's kind of incumbent on us to be prepared for that.
What are the musts? What are the needs?
Yes.
So let me just wrap up by talking about the calendar, which is in front of us, just to make sure everyone has a couple of dates. First is there's a series of listening sessions, I guess. One is June 1st. I apologize, I don't know for the location. It's one of the middle schools. I think that one's at Coolidge. January 16th is also at a middle school. I believe that one's Parker. And then January 7th is actually at the one at the senior center during the day.
You mean June, right?
I'm sorry, June. Yeah.
Yeah.
So June 1st, 7 o'clock at Coolidge. And this is all up on the website. June 7th, daytime meeting, 1 o'clock at the Senior Center, Pleasant Street Center. June 16th, Parker Middle School, 7 o'clock. Town staff is planning to attend all three of those as best they can. Mm-hmm. I suggest all of our major boards, elected boards, be posted and invited.
I guess, I don't know, Mr. Chairman, is this a segue into the next item on the agenda, which is the...
Well, I mean, the financial discussion.
Yeah.
I would.
I think what we're going to have to do, as a courtesy to the public that's here for a hearing that we're 10 minutes behind on, I think one leads to the other, but in a more appropriate way, I think we need to open the hearings and deal with those things that are in front of us, we're a few minutes behind, and then kind of jump back from there.
Just a quick question. It's the intent that the board not call for the special election until after the town meeting concludes. Is that true? Is that what we discussed? Would we be closing that warrant on September 20th, I guess is my question, for the actual election?
Well, we've called the election.
No, you haven't yet.
We've not voted the warrant.
No. You haven't actually called for a town
meeting. We've scheduled it. We've scheduled it.
Correct.
We have not.
On August 16th, that's the latest date you can close a warrant for the special town meeting at your regular Board of Selectmen.
Right. I'm talking
so
about
will effectively
the,
call it,
the election itself.
Yeah, to your point, Dan, if the special election's on October 18th,
yep.
And that's a given, the special town meeting on September 12th, you must call the election by the next day. So my suggestion is you call it the night of the 12th at the end, at the last part of town meeting.
Oh, okay.
If you're waiting to give town meeting the courtesy of having the discussion,
mm-hmm.
you should call the election that night if you choose. You should have the vote to call the
So we would be posted for a meeting within town meeting?
Right.
That's okay under the charter?
Yeah.
Okay.
So why do we have a special town meeting on the 15th, just in case it goes over?
Well, yes.
And technically, does that still count as the 12th?
No. So it would really behoove all of us
to get it done on one
night.
Now, yeah, I would think so.
The reason I listed two nights is there's a slight possibility there might be other business that aren't related to this that you might want to carry over the second night. I don't know yet. Mm-hmm. So,
well,
for instance,
if we structure that meeting special inside the special.
Does it matter that the time he hasn't adjourned, signed, he died?
No, it doesn't. No. It just you're doing it as a courtesy to town
Correct.
Meeting. You just need to vote to call the election.
Okay.
And I think that, you know, when we, in the last town meeting, I tried to make that clear to them that we understood that we had certain obligations as a Board of Selectmen, but we felt it was incumbent on us to have a courtesy visit, and
yes.
that's what the special town meeting was about. So.
Right. But it's very important that if you want that special election, that the town clerk has to know on the 13th by law.
Okay.
So we know we have to get done that night.
So it means we can't adjourn at 12 o'clock, right?
Oh, you can't. Don't worry. Bill Brown won't care.
Well,
we can go to the next night.
Somebody can make a motion to limit debate to a time certain. That's in order.
I think there's a number of logistical things
we could do to be certain that we solve that issue.
I just don't want to go through all this work and then find out we screwed up on some technicality.
No, that's not going
to
happen.
You know, the selectmen can just announce the town meeting at 11 o'clock tonight. We're going to vote whether or not to hold a special election.
Right.
Knock yourselves out with debate.
Yeah, because we are the ones that actually are convened, called it.
Yeah.
And
we're the only one. Yeah, somebody asked me that in the precinct caucus. We don't appropriate. Town meeting's the only body that appropriates.
Right. Right.
But we're the only body that can call for elections.
Right.
That can raise the cap. And then they can appropriate subject to that vote later.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
I
think that we do need to come back to the extension of this discussion,
sure.
but I would ask the secretary to call a hearing to order.
Move that the Board of Selectmen.
Now you gotta have the hearing.
Yeah. Read the hearing.
The hearing. No,
I'll just read this.
Yeah.
As new as
you
know, we're learning.
Yeah.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on May 3rd, 2016 at 9 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., on approval of a wine and malt general on-premises liquor license for the Art Lounge on Haven, 78 Haven Street, Reading, Mass. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, from 7:30 to 5:30 Tuesday, from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m. and is attached to the hearing notice on the website. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or email prior to 6 p.m. on May 3rd, townmanager@ci.reading.mads, by order of Robert Lasher, town manager.
Okay.
Is anyone here from the Art Lounge? I'll go out and look for
them. I saw Brad out there.
Yeah,
oh, yeah, that's kind of funny hanging out.
The the Art Lounge and Bar.
They're at the bar.
They were sipping.
Sorry.
Yeah, no worries.
Good evening.
We're sorry.
So the hearing has been opened.
It is open.
It is open.
Yep.
Wanted to just start?
Yeah, please.
Chairman, members of the board, my name is Brad Latham. I'm with Judy Barrelife, my husband Scott. Both are members of the applicant, which is the Art Lounge LLC. I'd like to present to the town manager, if I could, the affidavit that showed the legal notice for certified mail and out to the abutters. Mm-hmm. One item we do have a request at the inception is that we would like to change two doors from that which is shown in the plan that was given to you with the application. I have a colored copy of it to the town manager. Basically, because of architectural access for issues, we have to minimize the changes to the building in order to avoid the implication of what would be failing owners' imposition requirements. The changes, if I may describe them, is a door to the back area that was not shown, I don't believe, in the building plan.
Right, that's fine.
And
right.
The bathroom door that was at the back of the building mm-hmm. is now shown to be in the corridor on the side going to the back room.
Yep.
That's done for a couple of reasons, for the convenience of the patrons and also for security of the back room. The back room is going to have a locked compartment where the liquid would be stored mm-hmm. when the facility is not operating. And that door would also be lockable and closed and not being used for that purpose. So I just, at the inception, wanted to mention that. Staple to that is the last page, it's actually paragraph 20 of the application. Basically, it said the initial application filed, no change. This narrative has changed slightly to describe the fact that of those two things I just outlined for you. So please forgive us, because what we're about to say, you've heard before, mm-hmm. But we have to go through this public hearing. We're talking about 78 Haven Street. The applicants have been residents of Redding for 24 years. They've had their own business here for 15 years. We believe it's an appropriate area of town for this sort of use. It will hopefully preserve the vitality of that section of Haven Street. Certainly a symbiotic use, as I described previously. This will help patrons that would facilitate and use this facility would probably, after the use, attend a restaurant in the area. There's adequate parking. If this is really an off-hour use, it would be in the evenings or on weekends when there's not a lot of traffic or parking in that area. The objective is to have art instruction or instruction in some form, perhaps the crafts as well, for someone to go and could attend classes given at the same time have a glass of wine or beer of their choosing. As we indicated previously, the applicants are more than willing to abide by any condition and offer a condition of no more than two drinks to a patron and have the classes be no longer than 3 hours in duration. I think that those are the major issues. This is a beer and wine application only. There's a limited capacity created by the facility itself. Be not more than 24 people in the facility at a time. I think that's pretty much it. So we'd be more than happy to answer any questions you may have. Thank you very much.
Bob?
Yes, Bob.
The applicant came in late today and suggested this floor plan change and represented that the building inspector would be fine with it. As we told her then, and I'll say to you now, you cannot approve this in good conscience tonight. The hearing can be continued. There's no need for them to come back. But I need to make sure that public safety and the building inspector see this new plan and have it in writing.
Sure.
It's not fair to do it any other way. We have a formal process.
Right.
I understand the issue that came up late today, and we should be able to handle it. It'll just be a formality. It does look simple. But they really need to have a crack at this and give a fair assessment to the selectmen. I'll certainly be in touch with you folks. I'm assuming this is simple. I'm assuming they'll say it's fine, and in which case it's really just a two-week formality. The hearing would remain open for 2 weeks and then be closed.
Yeah. In all of the respects, is the application in order according to staff?
Yes, it is. Yeah.
John?
Bob, could you, since we weren't all
in attendance the last time this was discussed at the senior center. Could you go through for the board the nature of the current liquor licenses that are outstanding and the change that would be required here so that we all...
Let me go over a proposed motion because I think that'll summarize some of the view of this. You know, when and if you get to approve this, I'll read the language. Move that the Board of Selectmen find that a wine and malt general on-premise liquor license for the Art Lounge LLC does serve a public need, and that there are sufficient remaining unused licenses for anticipated economic development or future restaurant businesses. So what the board has to rule on with every application under this category called general premise, first of all, whether it's all alcohol or beer and wine, you have a finite number of licenses. I'm going to say it's 10 right now. You have an economic development plan that suggests there's room for 7 or 8 restaurants. So it's going to be the board's call every time an application comes in front of them, and this is the first, as to, you know, does this serve the public need, and do we have enough in reserve so that we can fulfill our economic development plan? You know, town council has given you an opinion that there's a gray area somewhere in the middle there. But as long as you take this format and have a discussion and have in your own mind a number of restaurant licenses only to set aside, that's fine. But you can't discriminate against type of applications that come in unless it's just, it just does not pass muster legally, or in your estimation, it really does not serve the public good, the public need.
What is the number of licenses?
So for instance, if 6 paint and sip operations all come in and they're all in order, and you're willing to give 6 licenses to non-restaurants, they would get them. It doesn't, you know, you can't say, well, we want a variety. It's first come, first serve.
But you
can reserve for restaurants, for full service restaurants.
And the reservation is out of what capacity?
I think there's 12 right now. There's 12 available licenses.
12 general licenses.
But there's a lot of things in play right now in the community, so that's a rough number.
And so, and one of the things that happened, John, I think when you were on a business trip, was we added a class of license, which is where this fits.
I see.
We hadn't had that before.
Right. We talked about that at the senior center. So that's the general.
It comes out of the same bucket, general, but this is not found its nothing way to do with food service. So there, you know, if the board so desired, and let's say there's 12 licenses left, the board could grant 12 general on-purpose licenses and have 0 left for restaurants, should a restaurant come in after
Well, it's
that.
The public interest, I think, that the town council pointed out to us is the weighing factor.
Correct.
And I mean, so in this petition, in this discussion, I think, you know, cases being made relative to, you know, maintaining the vibrance of the Haven Street area and, you know, extending its business life into the evenings and on the weekends. So, you know, and I do think those are things, I mean, we do need to think about the public interest. I think that that's one of the criteria going forward.
Before we go there, though, if we could just revert back, does there have to be consensus on the board with regard to the reservation of applications for future restaurants, or is it something we each have an individual opinion of?
It's something you can formalize in advance, or something that can evolve as you narrow the list and, you know, come with less and less. It doesn't matter that you don't formalize it. In other words, you can do it case by case, and suddenly you can all have the epiphany on the same day that, wait a minute, we're down to 7. That's what we need to keep. There's no law about that, I'll say. There might be a best practice of doing it in advance to warn applicants.
Just so the board understands, I was here, a member, I think the only member of the board, the last time this came up, and I was actually strongly in favor of approving these kinds of applications. And maybe it was sitting through enough of these, but one of my, I'm in favor of this, don't get me wrong, but what I'm nervous about is the law of unintended consequences of not so much 6 more paint and sip showing up, but some other use for which we can't legally stop, which we would otherwise say, you know what, that really doesn't fit. Maybe you can decline it on the basis of it doesn't meet the public interest.
Yes.
And that's broad.
Well, is there any challenge there, any appeal, or is it done?
It's so case by case, it's really hard to generalize.
What recourse does the applicant have if we say?
ABCC.
Okay, and what, is that generally leaned in favor of towns that have said no, or? Don't know?
I don't know.
I'd be inclined to want to at least put a bogey in place for the reservation for future food service organizations.
See, I think that's something that we can, you know, with all due respect, John, I think that's something we can certainly discuss, but I don't know if that necessarily impacts what we're talking about with this petitioner's
only in
hearing.
That, it probably doesn't, but it helps frame what comes next,
right.
And it helps get us set up from day one so that if it happens again, you've got a framework to work with. You're right, it has nothing to do here, won't
right.
affect any of that at all, but I'd feel a whole lot better getting that
well,
out of the way.
Well, I certainly would have no problem with working with the town manager to be sure that we had this as an agenda item, just as we, you know, as we put agendas together. I don't disagree with you either, by the way.
Well, if we don't, is it prejudicial to the next individual that shows up where we suddenly pull it out of left it, you know, out of our pockets?
Legally, it doesn't matter, but to me, it's far better if you do it in advance.
Right.
Right. If there's any question in the ABCC's mind, that would eliminate that aspect of it.
Right.
Yeah. That you're acting on.
Well, if there's intent, and it doesn't have something to do with
against that individual
petitioner. You know,
correct.
If someone else comes.
I'd be fine if we did something and later revised it, rather than do it for the first time at a later date.
And this might actually become part of our new selectmen's policies.
Yeah.
Under
it is part of your liquor policy. Yeah.
We spent a lot of time and energy trying to organize kind of an economic development plan, and it came specifically with recommendations for trying to get food service and restaurants into town.
Clustering. Yeah.
And so, I mean, I would defer to, you know, in my opinion, defer to what's in that report right now, which could be revised up or down as the market determines. So,
do you remember the number that was in?
I think it was seven.
Yeah, I think it was. But I do just want to bring everybody back to the fact that I think we should be better spending our time right now questioning the petitioner if you have questions, because they've been here several times.
Mm-hmm.
They have done all the things that we've asked them to do. Now a new a wrinkle came in kind of at the last minute, and I understand why it's here, and I'm going to guess you're going to understand why we'll need to continue the hearing tonight, but I do think it's important for all of us to direct any questions specifically on this topic.
We got plenty, don't worry.
Go for it.
Is the intent to have more than one class an evening, or is the intent to be a single class, be a 3-hour session?
Would be possible, like on a Saturday, maybe not in an evening, but a class would start maybe at, say, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and
another at
six
and
then another
so forth.
7 to 10.
And so 24 is the max seating that you'd ever foresee?
Yeah, that's really pushing it, too. Yeah.
You've asked for the right to sell food in the application. Do you foresee that? From the reading from the letter from Galvin, where that's mentioned. I just had it on the screen.
Where is that, John?
It's in the packet.
It's in the packet tonight. One moment.
Right behind the diagram.
Yeah, so on tonight's packet on page, that's not a page, it's 5G22. General character of the business. I guess it describes the character of the business is to provide art classes, including the sale of food. Is your intention to sell food? So I'm reading from a document that's from the secretary.
Oh, here it is. It's an old one.
Under item 3?
I assume that's what he's reading from. I didn't finish it. Is it page 24?
No,
he's looking in 12.
Thanks.
Oh, it's the purposes.
Oh, the, okay.
The corporation's allowed to do it, but the application was not intended to serve food.
That was actually established like 3 years ago when food might have been an issue.
Your intention is not to serve food.
Which is allowed under the general category.
I understand.
And that, unfortunately, that was the application, so you can't change that.
Okay, I understand. Well, those are my three. You guys have anything?
No. Actually, I just have a quick, I'm familiar with the inside of your shop. I mean, your frames are all over my house. So how do you plan to configure? I know you have a long counter. Mm-hmm. They're basically going to cover that and then put seats around there. And then when you walk in, I think that there are displays there now. So do you plan on moving things in and out? And
what's going to happen is right now the right-hand side of the store has all frames on the wall, and there are framing counters. And then the left-hand side has some furniture with some giftware. The whole left-hand side is going to be emptied out, totally emptied out. The framing counters are going to change into work tables, the same height, only they'll be open underneath, with just the stools tucked under. Scott can come out during the day and still do. So it'd be just like the counters, only they're not going to be.
Oh, so you're just going to, you're reconfiguring.
Yeah, what I need for a frame shop is a wall of corner samples, a single counter to take an order, and then credit card processing, whatever, and whatever I take an order on can be open so in the evenings people can sit around it and do their projects. My biggest concern is that I keep my back room and I want that door there to lock it because that's where I do my production and I store people's artwork.
Right.
Okay. But basically the whole front of the store, I need like 10% of it. I just need that one counter to take the order and everything on the wall.
And that stuff on the wall stay.
Yeah, that's my product, so. Okay. The rest of it, it's fill, it's fluff, the gifts, the pieces of furniture, all gone. Sale starts soon.
Oh, so you're going to stop that as part of what you're offering, as opposed to just taking and putting in the back in
no,
the classes?
No, gifts, that'll be empty. That's all gone.
This license would come up every year for renewal, right?
Correct.
Just like any other, so.
Yep.
Early December.
Other questions?
When would this continuation happen, Bob?
I'd suggest your next meeting, which I'll have to find. I'm sure it's 2 weeks from tonight.
The 17th? You have a time slot?
Yeah, let's look. tips. Looks tricky.
Also be a quick business.
Must be quick.
We could do it.
We could.
Have you advertised the paying class hearing yet? Classification and compensation hearing?
No.
We could do it at 7:20.
Okay.
We'll push that off.
Yeah.
So that'll be the motion.
Yeah, okay. And again, unless, I'll let you know no matter what, but I don't anticipate you needing to be present. You may want to be present just to see if it really happens.
Well, you can tune into RCTV.
So are there other questions for the petitioners? Okay, then I think that I would entertain a motion for continuance. And you guys have been here so much. I mean, you switch sides, though. You usually sit over there, so you mix it up a little bit. I feel like you've been here as much as we've been here.
Can I have a public comment?
What?
Public comment?
Yeah, you should ask.
Oh, yeah. Right. Public comment. It's an open hearing.
So you need to dial in line.
Huh? Okay. Well, I'll tell you. Thank God you're here, John.
Move to continue this hearing until our next meeting on...
17th.
May 17th.
May 17th at 7:20 p.m.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
See you then.
Okay, next.
Oh, okay. Okay, thank you.
Well, we don't close the hearing.
No, you don't do that.
Okay, so we have a transfer of all alcohol package store license from Busa.
Yeah.
Reading Liquors.
Yeah, there's no. Yeah, there's no. Are you going to read the page 28? 28.
Second to last.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Okay.
I'll keep you honest.
No, I couldn't find it. To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on May 3rd, 2016 at 9:15 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., on the transfer of an all-alcohol package store license from Busa Reading Liquors Incorporated to HT Reading Liquors LLC, 345 Main Street, Reading, Mass. Copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday to Wednesday, Thursday, from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.reading.ma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on May 3rd, 2016 to town manager at ci.reading.ma.us by order of Robert Lelasher, town manager. Hearing is open.
Hearing is open.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Thank you for your time this evening. My name is Attorney Tom Fothergill. I represent the HT Reading Liquors LLC, the petitioner this evening. With me is Tarak Patel, who is the manager and member, along with his brother Hiram, and he would also be the manager on duty for this. Essentially, what we're looking for is leave to transfer the licenses currently held by Busa Liquors to HT. This is a straight asset purchase agreement between the two parties. Nothing will change other than the Busa name will be gone. The business will stay the same, the structure will stay the same, the layout will stay the same, the only thing will be a different owner. Mr. Patel's family has owned the stores, they own four, currently up in the Merrimack Valley area, which he has worked in himself as well as his brother for over 10 years now, so he has experience. He recently completed the TIPS training as well. They do have a good track record with the family, and they want to continue that, obviously, here in Reading. And we're obviously seeking the approval of this body to do so. And we'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
You said he recently finished TIPS training?
Yes.
So was that his first opportunity to do so?
I believe so. Was that your first opportunity to do the TIPS training?
It was my first opportunity, but I did recently complete it, yes.
So you've been in the business 10 years, and this is the...
Well, his family's been.
Family's been.
He's worked part time.
Got it. Okay.
At some of the family stores. He's an actuary, actually.
Thank you.
Are you going to be an on-site manager?
No. In the beginning, I'm going to be, and then I'm going to hire a different on-site manager.
Okay, that would have to come before us, also.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Bob, can you remind us? In some of the licenses, we declined the sale of certain kinds of products like nips and things of that sort.
Only in one case.
Yeah, my recollection, that was only over by the grocery stores, by Market Basket and Stop and Shop, one iteration ago.
And that was actually at their request for some reason.
Yeah, and they requested, they offered it. I wouldn't have offered it.
Right.
They offered it as a condition, and the board said fine at the time. And this is, I don't know, at least 10 years ago.
And there's no such restriction. Anywhere else.
No.
And just to point out, on page 29, the police department have checked out the applicants, and they both checked out fine.
Mr. Fothergill, I know that perhaps the history in Reading is we've taken a really dim view to service of minors. And from my view, this is an opportunity for us to kind of restate that posture to new applicants and transferees. Mm-hmm. Alcohol is just one of the many drugs that gets into the...
Thank you.
See, he's serious.
it was for those at home, that was a spider.
I just woke up half the TV audience.
All of us going like this. We take a real dim view on service to minors. We had a circumstance. We've had a couple of isolated circumstances, but one recent repetitive case, and... I just counsel you and the applicant to please stay diligent, because it may not be when you're there, it may not be even something you know about, but it has a real dire effect on the business operation, I can assure you.
And this is a store that we've never had a problem with.
Never.
You know, it's been a real pleasure, because there have been others that, you know, Really having some trouble with that. How's your arachnophobia? Is it kicking up?
As a father of a 19-year-old, I can certainly appreciate that. Because it was 18, and I was 18, I believe.
Me too. We all enjoyed that run, but it's gone.
Yeah.
No further questions. Any questions from the public?
Does the store sell tobacco products today, by the way?
They sell tobacco products?
Yes.
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, we do.
Okay.
Got to be the same age in this town.
Yeah.
So, you know.
The state, yeah.
Well, I think it's state. Change it. They have not yet.
Yeah. No, we have it at a local
state. State, I mean.
Yeah. The state hasn't changed it yet. It doesn't sound like there's any other questions, none from the public. But I'd just like to take the opportunity while this hearing is open to comment on the store that you're buying. It's been a great citizen in town, been very supportive of every, you know, cause, and you know, it's been a pleasure doing business.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
It's been a pleasure to do business in the town already.
Thank you. I'll do it.
Oh, no, I was just reading the application. I'm sorry.
Okay. Move the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the transfer of the all-alcohol package store license from Busa Reading Liquors LLC to HT Reading Liquors LLC, 345 Main Street.
Second it.
Discussion. All those in favor? 5-0.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Oh, no, we have to just close the hearing.
Let's close it.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the transfer of the all-alcohol package store license from Busa Reading Liquors LLC to HT Reading Liquors LLC, 345 Main Street, for a term expiring December 31st, 2016, subject to the following conditions. All bylaws, rules, regulations of the Town of Reading and the Commonwealth of Mass shall be followed and subject to satisfactory inspection of the establishment by the town manager or his designee.
Second. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Oh, you do.
That's me.
Yeah.
All those in favor. We're going to get this right sooner or later. We're not going to do it.
Who's
friggin' rules?
Who's on first? Who's on first? What's on second?
Thank you.
Congratulations. Best of luck.
Good luck.
Welcome to Reading.
Welcome to Reading. Thank you very much.
I guess we're good with the rules, the protocol.
I know. We get to where we want to be.
Don't stand on the formalities.
Okay. Well.
All right.
Well, we come to the place that we kind of flared away from, which is a financial update. And I think given the recent discussions that we had with town meeting and the ongoing discussions we had, it's timely, and it ties back into the calendar discussion we were having. Bob, do you have some comments you'd like to make to kick it
open? Just a few. I'd like to elaborate a bit on Chairman Halsey's early remarks that, that John and I have met with our assessor, shared with Wakefield. And he's identified three, what I'll call, relatively simple and straightforward articles of town meeting that will all help address the elderly, low-income citizens in town that own a house, that own property. And it's relatively small help to them in the big picture, but, you know, $500, $1,000 for each of them is meaningful. So one of them is to expand the senior tax work program to allow a higher dollar threshold. Mm-hmm. One is to index the asset and income figures that we use to inflation, so that they're allowed to grow over time.
In
so
that program?
Yeah, in that program.
No, is that a state program?
Well, we can accept Mass General law that allows us to do these things. Right. So you have local control over many facets of it, but yeah. It is allowed by state law.
I thought we accepted this, the work your tax off.
You did, and you recently went through town meeting and increased it from 500 to 750.
Yeah.
Now we're suggesting 750 or 1,000, and we'll present you peer community data showing you why 1,000 is a good number. And just so the board knows, we have approximately 20 folks in the senior tax program. It's not a large amount.
Okay.
And they have to, if I remember correctly from when we did this last time, they have to be eligible based on income as well
income
as net worth.
Assets, and it's a pretty difficult hurdle.
Yeah. Yeah. And their house counts as part of their net worth.
No, it's assets excluding your house.
So if they have a like an IRA,
right?
That hurts.
Right.
The numbers are small.
Yeah. They're all small numbers. Mm-hmm. It's people who have a hard time staying in their house, basically, right, financially. And you saw from Jane's survey, finances were the second biggest worry.
Yeah.
Right behind medical, which was kind of disturbing, actually.
Was there a third article?
You said there were three.
They're all in this flavor. Okay. There's a couple of pieces of that last one to index it up. I'll get to the
details. But it's all in under the adjusting and tweaking the program.
Yes, this is all things that, in my estimation, and you'll decide, should go forward to a town meeting regardless of anything else that happens.
Mm-hmm.
These seems like things yes. that you just ought to do.
And these yeah. three things are the things that affect this couple of dozen
yes.
people.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things I was asking Jane about, is like, you know, what about the, you know,
right.
the undiscovered?
Right.
You know?
Well,
how
about these are people that we are yeah. aware of.
I was going to say, there's got to be more.
Right.
There could easily be more right? that, yeah. you know, could fit into the category.
Yeah, and the assessors have attempted to reach out. You know, after listening tonight, I'm wondering if they need to reach out more through Jane's group and make sure there's coordination there.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how much of that happens, honestly.
Do we know how many citizens are availing themselves of the state circuit breaker provisions?
That's sort of part two of this discussion. Okay. So this is things that I think John and
right.
I believe should go forward.
Right.
And then there's a couple of other permutations on a much broader audience, I'll say, of seniors that live in their homes. There's philosophically two very different approaches.
Mm-hmm.
There's communities to our west that one each has taken each of these. They both achieved it through home rule petition, which is the route we would have to go. I don't want to use community names. One of them, there's lots of ways to do it. The best way to do it, in my estimation, you have to consider the workload on the town staff. So the best gating item to me is anyone who files for the circuit breaker at the state income tax level would qualify. You can set up a different method in which your own staff evaluates assets and income level, but it's far easier to administer if, you know, folks that qualify for the state income circuit breaker automatically apply to your program to be determined. So that's step one, and that applies to both of these approaches, or could.
Mm-hmm.
One
the circuit breaker is for it's for
it's essentially
elderly?
Your property tax is or this much of a burden on your income.
But is that age related, or have you have to be
so.
A certain
it
age?
Has to be yeah. a certain minimum age and higher, and then it has to be again asset based, income based. But the key is your property taxes, $6,000 a year, is X percent or more
right.
of your income.
I think the income limits are a little more generous.
Yes,
than the other point.
They are definitely.
They are. Yeah. Definitely.
You said apply, Bob. You don't have to be awarded.
That's one of the notes. It's for each of these programs, folks in town would have to apply for this every year.
Yeah.
So there's a bit of a burden on them. There's a bit of a burden on our staff.
Well, the situation can change.
They
can win the lottery.
Exactly.
They don't qualify.
Exactly.
Or
so
you know.
In the first year that you do either of these approaches, I'm going to pick a number. 700 people might qualify. 2,000 people may apply until they figure out, oh, I don't qualify.
Yeah, don't bother.
Don't bother. So, you know, administratively, there will be a certain burden on staff, and he's willing to handle it. He will handle it. But I think the important difference is the two approaches. One is you leave revenue on the table. You don't collect it. The other is you reallocate that revenue within the single family property class. So let me give you the two examples. Let's pretend we have the exact same objectives, which is to save $500,000 for people that qualify, to take $500,000 as a group off their taxes. The first thing to realize is that you have the ability to set up any rules you want, but I think staff is going to suggest that you graduate it by income, so that the less you earn, the more you save off your property taxes. It could just be $200 a person, $500 a person. You pick a number. It's better, we think, if you do a graduation, because then people who are close may not bother applying every year if it's $20. And
right.
that may save on administrative costs.
So they'd have to supply a tax return when they apply?
We can get that from the state. They don't
have
to.
They don't have to do that.
Yeah.
So let's agree that 500,000 is the objective, and it's going to be a graduated system.
We don't know if 500,000 is the number.
Where the number comes
actually,
from.
Actually, you can agree on a number, and the assessor can target that number, mm-hmm. and then back into it.
Peanut butter.
Your rebate is calculated based on, these are all the qualifiers.
You're writing the rule.
Right.
Yeah.
But if, let's say, you hit a recession, now more people are making less money.
You still do 500,000. The amount you get back
doesn't
may change.
Change.
You don't have to do it this way, but we agreed this is the best way.
It's a fixed benefit.
Because otherwise, you don't know what your exposure
it's
is. It could be half a million, except
right.
it go to
I
a
mean,
million.
If it turns into a million, you got a whole different problem on your hands.
You know, we're asking the taxpayers to go to pay more, but yet we're going to leave money on the table. It doesn't seem smart.
So the first option, which one of the communities has done, is leave money on the table. Give up 500,000 of revenue, period, end of story. Those that qualify, you give them a break, they don't pay. And that's it. A very wealthy community that's doing this. The other option is to do the same thing, except, well, we don't want to give up that revenue. The default is you can reassign the collection of that revenue within the property class, in other words, residential. So you can't share it with commercial or open space. It has to be reallocated within residential. So people save 500,000, everyone else has to pay that somehow.
So just to,
it
prorates out, probably.
So you remember we discussed the exempting the lowest 100,000 of everyone's
house? That's different. That's residential exemption, is that?
Yeah, that's within the residential class, just like this is. That has no, you know, you may do regressions on income versus house value.
Yeah.
But it has no direct correlation.
Right.
It's the same philosophical idea, but this directly targets income.
I like that.
How much is it going to cost
you? You can be a big house,
you
can be a small house. Your income is the key.
So you take the 500, and our property levy is 82 million. That's commercial.
Let's use 50 million for residential because that's pretty close, which is why I picked a half.
Okay, so you got 1%. You got a peanut butter around.
Right. Right.
And this would take probably the place of the residential.
I think so.
Because that's a lot.
I don't think it. In looking in the discussions that we've had, I don't see how you do both. I think you do one or the other.
That's right.
And frankly, this one seems to me to be much more targeted towards the audience that needs the most protection.
Yeah.
You know, so the people that Jane is talking about tonight.
That way, if they live in a $600,000, $700,000 home, but they have a low income, they won't get whacked as badly as if we did a residential exemption shifted uniformly
yes.
people up at that level.
Yeah, I mean, that an across-the-board exemption could have unintended consequences of the kind you describe.
Right.
It could be catastrophic. It could be,
right.
It could be worse
right.
on certain individuals than if you had done nothing at all. The implication of you know how you spread that you know that revenue you know that you can't leave that kind of revenue on the table when you're in the middle of asking for an override. It doesn't make sense. This I think is a very interesting approach,
and that requires legislative approval.
Yeah, I've already talked to our two reps and like in April, March, you know, they're fine. And it turns out that there's another half dozen communities looking at this exact option. No one really wants to give up the money.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of people are facing the same demographic issue, the same. And people, for a variety of reasons, want to keep the seniors that are in their town in their town.
Right. No, it's a great concept, which we discussed theoretically when we did our hearing. I think what we've done is we've opened the door. Where we've now added another matrix in the whole override discussion, which is the not only how much are we going to ask taxpayers to pay and what are those services going to go for, but now who is actually going to be paying the taxes. And I'm assuming that if we entertain this strategy of trying to help folks stay in their homes, that we're also going to be very open to the discussion of the split tax rate, which also goes to determine who pays. Because from what I'm hearing, it sounds like if we enact some version of this shifting of money within the residential property, you're asking certain homeowners to be double down on. One is that their taxes are going up because of the override, and two, let me finish, please, that they're going to be taking on a share of some of their, what their neighbors were paying, whereas a couple of classes of property do not have that. And so I'm certainly open to discussing all this, but I just want to be really clear that my position is going to be that we don't discuss one without the other, because I think what you're opening up is just hitting a certain class of taxpayers a little bit harder, while others do not get hit as hard. So I'm just going to sort of put that out as a discussion item. I'm all for open for discussing the who pays, but you just can't look at one without the other. And that's,
it's almost surprising there's no provision in state law of a similar thing to the residential exemption in the commercial side. Because you
there
could
is.
Make you could well not so exactly
there's a small
it's tough to shoehorn some of those properties in.
Well,
it's one that doesn't fit.
It doesn't fit well in this town.
Do we have like more updated data? I know we talked about it. Victor said
he's
was going to look
same
at
data
it.
As he showed you in November.
There's some that
next November, but not
the current enough. Exemption.
You've got, you don't have 20% of the businesses that even can apply,
yeah.
Right. Let alone qualify. So I mean, let's open it to discussion.
No, I'm happy to discuss anything. It seems like there's two things I worry about. One is you're opening up Pandora's box, where we're going to be the wise statesman to try to determine who loses and who wins. The obvious one where people have difficulty staying in their home, to me, is a different case. You've got people that are on the edge, they are in their, presumably in their golden years, and that to me is a different animal. But I think once it veers into the camp of what other levers and knobs do we want to pull, I get really nervous. I'd also make the obvious point that we're talking about 1%, which is almost a rounding error, whereas the split tax, you rapidly get to 10 and 15 and 20%. But let's have that argument another day.
And I think this is, if we're talking about it, we're going to be in the community. Let's hear what folks have to say.
Well, we do want to hear what they have to say.
Absolutely.
And we do want them to also understand what they're asking for. Because sometimes, right. It's been my observation, particularly when we see some of the mail we all get, is that there's some misapprehensions about how certain pieces of government and parts of the tax law work.
Right.
And it's really important that people understand what it is they're asking about. So, and I think it is fair to talk about everything. I think we should. If we're not doing that, then we're not. My opinion is we're not doing our job if we
Correct.
Don't talk about all of it. But it's also our job, I think, when we are the driving force behind putting something on a ballot, we really have to take seriously our obligation to educate.
Right.
That's paramount in my opinion, so that people can make a decision that they feel like they're informed enough to make the decision. That's really important, because it will have implications. We're not talking about a small amount of money for anybody.
And we talked about doing this in advance, probably in advance of the special town meeting, taking some position as a board. Now, would we be doing this for both fiscal years at once, FY 17 and 18?
I think what you'd be doing, if you will, in, let's say, just August, is, excuse the word, taking a ceremonial vote that this is what we intend to do when we actually have hard data in front of us.
So this would be the...
Now, some of it is these three, I'll say, unrelated articles that we want to support. And there's this fourth one, which is shifting tax responsibility around. And, it's up to the board whether to tie that into an override or not.
Yeah.
You could do it regardless of an override. You could do it in
But the override would be for FY 18 money. Is it your recommendation that we start this process for FY 17? In other words, the vote we would have taken in December
or
still...
I would suggest it all be tied into FY 18. So that'll be a discussion with the assessors.
Only 18?
Yes, but...
Okay.
It's complicated because there's estimated tax bills for 6 months and then actual ones.
Yeah.
If you don't word this properly and instruct the assessors properly, you'll get a double effect in your first year, because the first 6 months are the old rate and the last 6 months is the new rate.
and it's double what it would be amortized over a full year.
And the hammer, it's like hitting, you really.
It's front ended.
You know, it really hits them right between the eyes.
But there is a state law that allows you to smooth it over the year through an estimation process. Right. So what staff has tried to do is look at all the unintended consequences, what is all the risks. And the community that has implemented this has had an unintended consequence of a lot more people qualified than they ever imagined. Because they have a well-known, wealthy-sounding community, they didn't realize they had so many seniors that had the circuit breaker.
So they hadn't done the work.
So they might have been thinking 500,000, and they got whacked with 800,000. Mm. And the impact on the taxpayers that were paying was much larger than it was advertised.
So the lesson learned there is, you know, go in with your eyes open. Is there any way?
So the lesson learned to us was, can we go in with a fixed dollar price rate and DLS it? Sure.
But you'd still want to know the likely number of.
Absolutely.
Could we? Right. You'd learn that.
And that can be forecast.
Victor's already got.
He's working on it
for all that.
Yeah, we got some good data to model here.
That's
excellent.
I think there's a real value in either groups of one or two of us, with Bob and Victor, having these discussions to brainstorm, to ultimately have him come and visit us. You know, as a body, to be able to have a public discussion.
Where's the board's head on doing these all at once? These the three little things, and then the circuit breaker thought, and then anything else. Or doing it as one package, or rolling them out independently? I could see arguments for both. Doing them all together, you're guaranteed to have a long, thick meeting, and discussions on one could easily bleed into another. Doing them separately, you might be able to meter them out and actually have a meaningful discussion.
You kind of want that nailed down before we call a special election.
Well, to Bob's point, some of this might be independent of that, right?
So I, you know,
some
of it is the three smaller things.
For example,
I mean, when you look at those, you just say, "Of course, we should do that."
Yeah, you could do that anytime.
And these are people that you know that clearly.
So you don't.
There's already an established need, and what we're doing is making sure that. That they continue with certain protections.
To me, that's a no-brainer.
That's kind of what I think, too.
So you don't bother Tom meeting.
I think that's, to me, that's just good conscience on behalf of the Board of Selectmen once they understand it.
So those are three articles go to the next available town meeting.
And that's independent of it. I mean, we could be doing that anyway. Yes. I mean, I remember we did it, we raised it from 500 to 750.
Right.
I mean, that was, we asked ourselves, why did we wait so long to do that?
You know, that's just us paying attention to what we should be paying attention to.
Do you know where peer communities are at that level? Is it 750?
Generally 1,000. They were closer to 750 five, six, 7 years ago.
We're lagging.
We're just behind in getting it done. We just need to get, that's why I think we need to get it done.
Yeah.
And then the circuit breaker discussion has to be tied to the override.
And actually, I should take just a minute to describe the third piece, because I really didn't. Not a lot of people know that you can defer your taxes if you meet certain income and asset qualifications.
Until you sell the house?
Or you die. Okay. And the interest rate at which you defer your taxes, we can set. So one of the articles is to lower the interest rate. I think it's from 8% to 4%. So again, it's not big money, but it, you know, in the right circumstances.
How many people defer their taxes now?
Not very many at all. And the risk of that is, and this is an interesting, you know,
it's a very
Victor's discussion. They have very careful discussion with the taxpayers and their heirs when possible. If you defer taxes and you pass away while you still own the house, the estate has to pay 16 or 18% in arrears, retroactively, to all the taxes deferred.
So if you don't move the house during your lifetime,
I
mean, the implications of that. Let's say that you did this for a period of 5 or 6 years, and you deferred $25,000 worth of taxes.
Yep.
Instantly, that will be a $50,000 bill.
Yep.
If you die,
the heirs will have mom and pop pay the taxes.
And then that'll be a lien against. Yeah.
And so the discussion the assessors have is, look, maybe you will die, but you can stay in the house, and instead of your heirs inheriting $450,000, it's $400,000. It's your call. But it has to be clearly explained.
It's a little bit more complicated.
Probably so.
Well, I mean, it has to be out there so people are aware of it.
But the interest rate at 4 instead of 8 is clearly a good thing if someone wants to use it and it's appropriate.
Yeah, but they want to use it as a bridge towards selling their home or, you know.
There could be some trust work you could do, but that's complicating it for the individual.
I mean, the thing is, I don't think lowering the interest rate is gonna be a a mitigating factor in having more people apply for this. People will apply for this either A, because they know about it and it fits, and you know, I would think more people, I don't think from 4 to 8 is going to change how
you know,
many people do.
It's 250, 500 bucks a year savings, 4% worth of interest on a tax bill. It's not a big deal, but again, for this person in this circumstance, it might be enough.
And you can't, and you don't know how many people are doing right now?
Victor would know. I don't know.
Yeah, there are some. Very many. I mean, but, yeah. But you know, if you're having that discussion with the heirs, the heirs are going to pay the taxes.
Yeah.
It just, you know, or buy the house. You know, one of those two things.
Well, what's the interest rate on taxes in arrears if I don't pay my taxes for 10 years?
16.
Same with water bills, right?
Yeah.
Well, water bills unpaid after a year become tax titles.
Right.
And they go to 16%.
Yeah.
And that's really not our choice. That's,
no.
You know.
That's state law.
That's state law.
So I do believe all three are standalone good things to do regardless, and I don't usually step in your shoes, but this is just obvious.
That's right.
Yeah. The other things, I think you need to decide, do we pair them, do we partner them, do we do them separate, when do we do them?
I think part of that comes out of the listening sessions.
Yeah.
That helps us formulate, you know, a suggested plan.
We're going to have material then to present.
Well, that's why I brought it up tonight, because you can ask simple questions of the audience, like, do your favor giving tax relief to people that are X, Y, and Z qualify in this circumstance. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm wondering, should we be thinking about
maybe
mobilizing those?
Yeah, I was thinking about it. And then B, who should pay? And you know, list them out. Commercial, residential.
Right. Is there an efficient way to go beyond these groups? Because, you know, they tend to be small, full of activists, let's face it.
Yeah.
Like a Survey Monkey kind of thing?
Absolutely. I would actually suggest a survey is better than those voting devices.
Yeah.
I would just say, go
you're
to gonna, the
you're
website.
You're going to reach a much bigger
tool.
Well, yeah. It's
I think the way you create, how you craft that survey is key,
yeah,
and that
I
needs
agree.
To be really thought through.
We have to explain a little about what you're asking about, too.
You know,
that's why I'm starting to think about, and we'll discuss further, what kinds of information are you looking for?
Well, you know, good
you're
survey.
You're looking to listen, but you're also looking to get in some information early on.
Good surveys. We've seen both flavors here in town over the last handful of years. The recreation survey was powerful, and it had huge return. I think the library did a survey, didn't they?
Yeah.
That was, you know, it was also very powerful. It sounds like what the Elder Services Group did also was very good, very telling, and you could just sense that there was so much more to say about that survey that just time didn't permit tonight.
As soon as you see what else there is to say, you'll say, oh, here's some more things we should have asked, because that always happens.
Right.
But you're better off getting 80%, right?
Yeah. You can't wait till you got it perfect.
I'd err on the side of simple and get 80%.
The key is going to be, though, I mean,
but these are not simple.
These are not
simple concepts. I mean, you're going to be asking people, are you willing to pay $400-$600 a month more in taxes to get this level of services? So that is one whole kind of, you know, internal debate that you're going to have with yourself. Then you're going to be asked to say, will I be willing to pay $650 so that my neighbor can stay in her house and I still get these services, right? Then you're going to be asked to say, am I willing to pay $650 to keep these services when the tax rate on business is 20% lower than it is in the surrounding town? Yeah, I want more services and I want to help my elderly, but you know, now you're opening up class warfare here. So I think the way you ask these questions is really important. And people,
it has to be even-handed. It has to be informational,
right,
and even-handed.
Can, yeah.
And here's my fear. I think all these things that we've been looking at, you know, again, let's pat ourselves on the back for being creative, but trying to think out of the box, for trying to stretch, you know, a dollar into a dollar 25 every time we look at something. But my fear here is that by trying to do this is that in a very short period of time, by the way, there's just so much information and so much decision that people will just default to no.
And then
you know, what we've done is we're trying to be Solomon here and do the right thing for the town and try to help people who need the help, but also, you know, address a whole fairness issue. And it just becomes just so overwhelming that people say, you know what? Let's see what it looks like with no services for a year, and then, you know.
Well, there is an alternative, because if you look back, not so much on the debt exclusions, but on the overrides, you have a history of two things happening. One is the prevailing boards at the time really kind of letting it be out there, but without necessarily putting a lot of time, energy, and effort into education and awareness. And the result was we've never had one pass the first time through. They had to wait for blood in the streets before, you know, people said, okay, we got to do something now. I'm not convinced that, personally, I'm not convinced that that's the right approach. I think that we have to give people credit for, you know, a level of awareness and understanding that if we give them that information, that they're going to... I hear what you're saying, that if it gets too complicated...
But that's on us.
But that is on us. It's kind of really important that we keep it simple but informative at the same time.
Yeah, I mean, that's what leaders do. I mean, we come up with these ideas and we try to... We bring it to our constituencies.
Is it worth it to talk to a... I hate to spend money to figure out if we're going to spend more money. Is it worth it to talk to a consultant that deals in... I mean, you're talking about dealing with the public and how they perceive your question.
Public government here with nothing is simple. Procure that would be not...
To Barry's point in regards to, you know, the surveys, they're very tough, because you can ask the question of five different people, the same exact question, and five different people have five different understandings of that question, and that's going to influence their answer.
We do it at town meeting all the time. We did it in the prior town meeting to the most recent, where we said, if you had an override, forget the formulation of the question, if there were an override, where would you tend to want to come down on? And I think the average is 5%. There were some that said no. There were some that said 20, but I forget the total, but it was pretty clear it was around 5. Mm-hmm. That's a fine question to ask. And you are going to get a distribution. You're not going to get everyone lined up at 5. You're going to get some that say no, N-O, what part of no didn't you hear? And you're going to have people that say, hey, that's not enough. I want to be 20.
Well, we also now know the ask may be bigger than 5.
I'm just pointing out that people will respond to a simple question, and you'll get reasonable responses. The danger here is if we get it too complex, you'll get the confusion.
Analysis paralysis. Yeah,
that's why I think to Barry's point, you ask a simple question, which is, it's either a social policy or a math question. Do you think tax policy should help the lower income seniors in this town? That's a simple, that's yes, no. You know, what's the difference with the number? It's just yes or no. Or you go the more complex math question. Right. Are you willing to spend $50 more to keep...
How much more would you willing to pay to keep the...
Right. But maybe you don't mind that one so much. You don't have to know enough. Yeah. But I don't know.
Another thing that June 1st is our first sort of going out to the neighborhood. I mean, I know we're talking about it here, school committee, library trustee. I mean, have we formed a working group or of everybody to kind of come up with the agenda for these meetings? And
two chairs, John, Chuck, John Daugherty, and myself have been meeting. We're just now to the point of where we're talking now, getting sort of agendas. My imagination for the first three meetings is really not to put out a lot of information, but really just to listen. What are your concerns? Mm-hmm. Possibly even unscripted. But that's probably a little too dangerous. You got to have something.
You got to have some framework,
Vice Chair.
Yeah.
I think what needs to happen early on is not a prediction, maybe just a reiteration of what a little bit of what happened at town meeting, which is to say, if we do nothing, if nothing happens, this is what the operating budgets are going to look like for year one going forward, year two going forward. This is how much money we're going to have to spend. And then, you know, each of the groups talk about what that means for, you know, obviously we're not going to predict cuts, but just to say that, you know, it could give an example of what a 1% operating budget would do on the town side.
Right.
John's got to do that for the schools.
Maybe total positions.
Positions, right, because you're not going to say we're going to cut this or going to cut that.
And
you
that's
can't
department,
do that,
but, that department.
Right. But you could say that, you know, certainly there's no growth, I mean, so anything that you hope for and you want, it's not going to happen.
I think if you start there, you're going to end up with a meeting that ends there. I think you got to start at, why are we here? It's this slide that Bob did three meetings ago, which says it's health, or it's,
right,
it's the accommodated cost. And we're here because of that. Nobody did bad. Right. We're doing great.
Yeah.
But we're
and then this is if we do nothing.
From that, what's right. The trajectory? Right. Staying neutral means you're on a 2%.
And also talk about the revenue side, how we raise less commercial surrounding compared to surrounding communities. We have more kids per capita.
All of those factors
all
that
those
are
factors
weighing,
need to be,
weighting factors. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you can say, okay, is that a backdrop? Let's now look at the budgets.
Yeah, I think a presentation no more than 10 or 15 minutes up
sure.
front.
Yeah.
I agree.
One
absolutely.
Person, Chris. Probably me.
Yeah.
We haven't, John.
Five definitely you.
Maximum.
Yeah.
It can't be a, you know, a long speech. It's got to be an informational dialogue that opens a discussion.
And then people will ask these questions.
Yeah.
Of, you know, well, you know, what does Danvers do, you know?
Do you think it's helpful to get into the peer community discussion? Our peers collect $55 million from residential also, but this much in commercial. Is that too much?
No, I think that's important.
No,
I think it's worth it. I think everybody, I think we need to put those kind of facts out.
I could probably hit five slides and cover the summary of what you right. heard in January very quickly.
You can, but I don't know if it's actionable. I don't know what you do with the data. Okay, that's a great history lesson, but what do you do with
nothing.
It?
Nothing. Yeah. You hear it.
Right.
Right. So
this
I'm not
is
sure.
What this is what Reading is, I guess, is what it is.
We don't have enough paying commercial
it's
property.
It's, if it's to set the context, I'm fine with it. If it's to try to suggest that we're doing something wrong, I don't think
nope.
it's helpful.
It's just to say, here's what Reading is, and here's what it isn't. No. And then
I think people have a misconception of what Reading is.
I do, too.
I think we're Burlington.
I mean, all you need to do is read your
email. Well, maybe not.
Read your email. And, you know, it yeah. tells that story. I mean, we all get a lot of email on topics. And honestly, I think sometimes when I read it, I understand why the person is saying that. But I think it comes from a position of misunderstanding about, you know, what's really happening. You know, and who we really are.
That's here. Well, there's the question of, here's what I want to be. I don't care what you tell me I am.
Yeah.
It's what I want to be. It's why I'm here. That's a hard argument to have with someone. This is what I want to be. This is what I'm willing to pay. Don't tell me what I am. Because that's what we face. You know, those discussions happen. And that's why it's important that you're talking about protecting the seniors. I can't afford what some other people want.
Some of your prepared remarks have got to head off at the pass, the objections, the expected objections about we're spending too much money here or
yeah.
all the usual misconceptions about what we're doing.
There'll be people who come out and say, you're wasting money on this. And that's fine. I mean, that's fine.
I just don't want
to
waste. I don't want to sidetrack the meeting. You're almost better off trying to attack it, but address it up front.
Yeah. Well, that's why that summary slide of showing 10, 20 years.
It's huge.
It's really simple.
Right.
It's like we've pushed a lot of bells and whistles and
right.
levers in that
right.
time, and we're kind of done.
Right.
We've done the best we
right.
can. Now we need your help.
Yeah, that was a very informative session.
Yeah.
And I just wonder. I wonder if it was so early in this discussion that it wouldn't.
Well,
I think it'd be valuable to bring it back. I think it was too early.
It was meant for you, though.
It's for us.
Yeah.
And maybe the department heads.
No one knows about it outside of this little group. We ought
and
to be just
okay.
singing that from the hills.
Yeah.
And FinCom then learned about it, and they thought it was interesting. It wasn't meant for anyone else yet.
Yeah. So, June 1st is fast approaching. What are the next steps?
What help do you need from the rest of
them? We're meeting next Monday morning at 7:30 for breakfast, four of us.
Okay. You should make a call to the library trustees as well to get them there. I've had a conversation, so I think they should be outreach too. They're important
piece
of this.
Well, it would be important to have that voice in lockstep with the other two elected boards.
Yeah, and then FinCom with a role to be determined. I think they agree that the first couple sessions, they'll attend and listen just like everyone else will.
That's good.
And then at what point do they have a more activist role is not yet clear, if at all. It's obviously advisory to town meeting. beyond that, I don't know.
How are we going to actually explain the consequences pro or con to town meeting? We're going to have some sort of a generic.
John and I haven't really, we have.
Scenario A, scenario B. That has to be laid out.
Yeah, I don't know. That's hard. That's.
It is.
That's very hard.
Without getting specific.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well.
Because we don't know yet. We haven't been through the whole vetting budget process.
Yeah, I mean. Yeah. Do you want to go through a budget process in the summer that does that? You almost have to.
Maybe a back of the envelope. That's what I was kind of driving at when I made my comments.
You don't have to have, like, names and faces, but.
Would you have, like, departments?
You need to know that the town.
Average salary is 50 grand. We need to find 500. Guess what?
This many.
Yeah, that came up at town. Those were questions that came up at town meeting about, you know, sort of our average salaries, right? Even if you just want to keep. Having the same people do what they do, forget about expanding services. If you want to pay them on average, how much does that cost?
Well, there's that too, yeah. Yeah, and the board will have to wrestle with some issues about, you know, a trash fee, for instance. That has nothing to do with laying anyone off, cutting expenses. That's a different kind of revenue. You know, the past APAS board, either 13 or longer ago.
Longer.
Said, if you pass this override, we'll never have another trash fee. And right. That's true. That board never did.
Right.
Now you're here.
Right. We also fought a war.
One of that board is here.
Okay.
You can't get away from me.
I don't think we should go there. Because there's a lot of places we can go there.
Why would you go there before the fact?
There's a lot of places we can go there.
Why do you want to raise that before the fact?
This is not what, yeah.
There's no point in raising it.
Well, the point is you need to know all your tools.
Yeah, well, true.
I do.
What is it? What Bill Brown said is great. You can't now take it outside the levy and free that levy amount up if you were.
I know.
That's not true?
No.
I don't think it was.
I don't think it's true.
We need to make sure it's not.
Yeah.
Yeah, you put a trash fee in something. Oh, you can't reuse that money anyway and get some levy back?
Well, he also has different ideas of the stormwater.
I understand.
Than lawyers do.
Right.
Well, my suspicion is that this conversation could go on all night.
Right. You want to ask for a public comment before?
No, we finish our end.
Do we have public comment on this topic?
No.
No?
You're the fifth estate here. He's just going to write it up.
Is there an appetite for more discussion tonight? Or do we?
I think the board has to be really careful about trying to do too much for June 1st. First of all, I'll be away for 10 days, but that aside.
Well, that's
really
good.
You're going to listen.
That's good to hear.
So you have to present something.
Mm-hmm.
But to present too much means you really weren't listening.
Yeah.
You know, what are your concerns? We've laid out a framework in 10-15 minutes that leads you to the conclusion that we're going to have to start reducing services.
Right.
Just that's a given. Okay, talk. You know, what are you concerned about? What's going well, what's going badly, what do you worry about?
Well, this is less about a presentation and more about a listening. It really is. I think it needs to be that.
Yeah.
We have to.
And we'll learn the first night whether there's a lot of people that just came to listen and they didn't have much to say.
Can we ask the question, are you personally concerned about a higher tax bill? Do we want to know that? Check the temperature of the room?
Well,
You're going to ask one side, you're going to ask the other side.
Concerned is a general question. I'm always concerned about a higher tax bill.
I just want to know what I'm getting for it.
Well,
right. That's
am
what
I
mean.
Impact,
that's
what.
Am I willing to for an exchange of services? That's the question. It is
willing
kind of an interesting question because, you know, this it's a very different question when you ask about how do you feel about the tax bill that keeps your schools running and keeps your police driving around and keeps the recreational field. I mean, when you ask me that question, it has a different meaning than when you ask me the question about what I'm willing to send to Beacon Hill or Capitol Hill.
I would hope.
Because they don't know how to spend the money, okay? Mm-hmm. And they're reckless with the way they spend the money. But, you know.
Our problem is we know how to spend the money, but our residential tax
well,
rate
in a local
high.
Government, I mean, so that open-ended question about taxes is a little unfair. I think I hear what you're saying, though, Dan. I think you do have to
somewhere in there.
There's a certain place where people have to recognize that all the code words aside, an override equals higher taxes, and higher taxes means less spendable income.
Yeah,
there you go.
And we know that.
Yeah.
And we just come around and say it. We understand it.
Yeah. I do think if we're going to be honest, we got to ask both questions. It can't be.
I don't disagree with that.
If you don't do this, the sky will fall.
But the language is very critical.
It's got to be non.
Always critical.
Non-motion.
It can't be biased.
Yeah.
It can't be biased language. It's got to be, and this is when we started this conversation 3 months ago. You know, somebody from the audience, I think, took issue with me saying that, that I didn't feel like we should bias the conversation. And I still don't feel we should bias the conversation. I think we need to be very clear about informational facts and present that in a way that people can digest without feeling like they're being run over on one side or the other.
Let me suggest a principle, though. I think it's important that you get, in all your information gathering, you get a set of answers to a constant set of questions. You can add to the questions, but the base set's got to be the same at all these informational settings, and it's also got to be on the web. If you ask different questions at every meeting, you'll never correlate the results.
I definitely agree with that.
You can start with what we did at town meeting.
Yeah, whatever the questions are, you ought to have that. One page of Bob's five ought to be, here's five questions, how do you feel about them? Show of hands or 1 to 5, where are you? And do that on the web. Because the folks that show up at the meeting are going to be a very different selective set that can get out that evening, right, want to talk about it, likely have strong opinions, and weren't out of town for a 3-week business.
And are probably pro-override.
Who knows?
Almost.
But the point is that they're probably passionate about the subject.
Yeah.
I don't know what side they'll be on. They'll be passionate.
Those meetings.
But if you put it on the web, you get more of the passive sampling. You'll never approximate everything, but you'll get more of it. And if you have a constant set, you'll be able to track it all.
Well, I think the survey idea is one that we cannot leave.
That ought to be a principle.
I agree with you, but I personally think the survey should wait till after your 3 listening meetings.
Yes.
Because otherwise you're biased.
That's
in the
no problem.
Sample.
That's fine.
And then they inform the question.
That's fine. Then, right. then the input comes out. It's only formative for the questions.
Right.
Yeah, these meetings may drive questions for the survey.
Right.
Well, I think they will.
Better understand how to ask.
That way you don't have to remember what set of questions you ask one group and another.
That's fine.
It's just all out there at some point somewhere.
Yeah, and that's why, you know, I agree. I think the presentation that you put on before is one of the best presentations to put out there. It's not a statistical, I put a bunch of numbers in divided by 5, and here's what I came up with. No, this is where we are. This is how we got
this
here.
This is how we got here.
Yeah.
Well, it did what it was supposed to do. It motivated a conversation. That, you know, that presentation that you put together caused us all to start a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
I think.
Okay.
What else we got?
That's it.
I'm done.
Move that the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at
10:29.
10.
Second.
30.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye, aye.
Everybody wants
Everyone's
to be chairman
the show.
Tonight.
Hey, big upset in Indiana.
Big upset.
Oh, yeah.